following announcement has been paid for by the...
That's okay.
Say, if this happens with every playthrough I've ever done, people lose interest. They can't... They have such ADHD that they can't hold interest.
You grew up with this game? This is one of your favorite games? I feel so bad for you. How did you put up with this?
China, they say. Chicky Chang, Wang, Charlie Chan, Chicka Chaka Chaka Cha.
Shut the fuck up. Fucking idiots. I'm here trying to play a fucking game. It's hard to concentrate when a bunch of little immature shits get into a fucking argument with my girlfriend. Fuck you.
Ah, yeah.
Oh, was it good for you?
You're the bitch because you don't play a fucking fighting game, you stupid cocksucker. You fucking walk back and shoot bullets. You're a fucking idiot. Your mother probably shafts you out, you fucking piece of shit. You are sick in the fucking head. And I stand by that statement that when that guy made that video, he's sick, mentally ill.
You told me to go die, Phil! What's up with that?
Oh my god, listen to the butthurt fanboys in this ring.
You didn't finish the game. You cheesed the game so much that it would be impossible. Ooh, you cheesed.
You fucking idiot.
And starting off with, from my left to my right, we got ourselves a reviewer, and yeah, that's pretty much it. We got Che.
Che,
you're on, bro. I don't even think he's here.
What a bitch.
Okay. Wow. Okay, anyway.
You forgot artist.
Don't worry. Our next person we have is Carl.
Sup?
And of course, the very next person we have is the person that does all our art, does all our crazy intros and shit like that. We have Superior Artist.
Sup, guys? Happy Halloween.
And of course, we have the originator of This Is How You Don't Plays, Evil AJ.
Sup?
And we have his ascendant, Loophole.
What? Okay, B-ball world order.
Jeez.
Oh, there you are, Shang.
Hey, everybody, what's up? I just had to change the settings to my mic, but what's up?
I introduced you and you weren't saying anything, but it's okay. Anyway, we also we have the president here of Sons of Kojima, Renegade Operative.
Yes, I'm busy stroking my e-dick to Kotaku articles.
Yeah. You're famous, man. You're famous.
Yeah, dude. Your fucking video spiked up in views really fast.
I know. It has 20K now.
And then we also have the co-host of the podcast, Fred.
What's going on, guys?
We're also joined by two guests, and I'll start off with Lemon.
Hello.
And we also have Slyspy.
How's it going, kids?
Alrighty. So, how are you guys doing?
Sly or me? I'll go first.
We can go in order. Lemon, Slyspy. How about that?
Yeah, order of importance. Gotcha.
We're doing age before beauty.
White people.
Oh. You're right. I am white. Anyways, I'm fairly queasy. I think I might have come down with a bad case of Ebola. Other than that, I'm fine.
Yes. Ebola, I thought maybe you'd get Lyme disease.
I'm going to roast you for that shit joke you just made later on.
Oh.
Yeah, we'll rip on him later on. It's okay.
And how are you, Sly?
I'm doing just fine. I apologize if I seem a little distracted at times. I'm expecting something soon.
No, it's all good, man.
Awesome. So let's kind of jump into it. A lot of our audience might know you as King Hate 4 Mods. So let's kind of jump into that. Where did you guys get started with Phil?
In terms of my viewing pleasure of Phil, which has descended greatly over the years, I believe it was 2008 when he was first getting started. At that time, I was actually going through a difficult time. I was rather homeless for about 3 months.
Oh.
Wow. Ouch.
Yeah. I also found Onision during that time when he was actually funny.
Holy shit.
Nice.
And then he decided to go all preachy, and so I ditched him.
Yep.
And then there was Phil, you know. I watched his stuff, mainly his Fallout 3 playthrough, best one. And Heavy Rain was alright, too.
That's it. This was around 2010. I didn't own a PS3, but I was interested in checking out Heavy Rain because I played Indigo Prophecy before, and it seemed like an interesting game. I didn't know what to make of it, so I started watching this dude's playthrough on YouTube. Some dude from Tokyo. He's like some Australian dude, but he was living in Tokyo at the time. But my problem with that playthrough was, like, he was messing it up on purpose, and I just wanted to see someone play it as, like, really trying to get through it. And I discovered Phil's playthrough of it. You know, this was back when it wasn't too many people doing modern game playthroughs, you know what I'm saying? And I felt his video was, his playthrough to me, the commentary was entertaining enough that when I was done watching it, I decided it was worth subscribing to him. So,
awesome.
Rest is history.
Awesome. So, I guess the next logical question would be, how did you guys go from just sort of being viewers to sort of taking the next step and becoming part of his staff?
I mean, that's all step by step. I mean, we didn't just become that, but, you know, I was on the forum when it just started. I wasn't very active. I was more active on the shout box than anything else. And then after a while, you know, I saw how corrupt the mods were, and I also lost interest in the community. So I was gone for a couple years, and then I decided to come back near the end of 2012. And I guess people liked me enough that and saw that I was rational, logical enough that I was offered a chance to become a helper. Which is like a figurehead title. You don't really get to do anything. You just tell the mods something's going on, and then they take care of it. But then after the new forum started up, I was asked if I could become a moderator, so I just accepted.
So essentially, it started more from a sense of purpose or a sense of duty towards the community than actually being in service of Phil as a fan.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, I still like the dude, but you know what I'm saying? It had nothing to do with him moderating the forum.
Okay, that's very interesting. I don't know maybe if a lot of people would know that, especially some casual observers. How about you, Lemon? How did you sort of start to take the next step from just being a fan to being more intricately involved?
Well, first let me go back to what Sly said. Go figure, Sly. Some of the original mods that Phil chose were corrupt. You know, let me just throw that out there.
Let me throw this out there, too. It's not like anybody reviewed them to see if they were any good at it. They just got picked out of a fucking hat.
That sounds familiar. Where have I heard that? Anyways, let me be straightforward with you. It was in 2011 that I was asked by Foos, who was no longer around, if I would like to moderate, and I chose to do so. After a little bit of apprehension towards the thought, because I was very busy at the time.
Sure.
Somewhat less busy now, but still quite busy, if you understand. It was myself and DX Michael. By the way, rest in peace, DX Michael. He decided to demod himself this week.
Oh, he committed seppuku.
He demodded himself because he didn't like the whole moderating thing anymore.
I gotcha. Sudoku. So, yeah, sort of,
Anyways, when we were asked, we were specifically asked to be more strict mods. Basically, we were supposed to be the assholes. The guys that nobody liked. Turns out, everybody liked us. And when I first got my position, I was actually incredibly strict to the point where topics actually became very difficult to have. I kind of feel bad about that.
You know, the interesting thing about that is nobody really complained about that when you used to do stuff like that, but I remember talking to you about being overzealous.
I remember that particular discussion. You and Hazer were having a talk in the thread about games, and I thought you guys were going off topic. I remember that talk.
But it was before that. It was before that. Before you even directly interfered in any topic I ever made, I noticed you were very attentive, but you were a little bit overzealous, and I felt like one day that would lead to something. That's when I talked to you about it.
Yeah, and it did certainly lead to something. But eventually I did slow down on the whole, hey, you're derailing the topic. You must talk about this only.
Yeah, well, you live and learn.
Awesome. I still kind of do that by setting precursors when a thread is first opened, like I did recently. I know people are going to compare subscriptions to donations, so I just said right off the bat, it's not about that. It isn't.
Yeah, that's not too difficult, though. You're not being difficult or nothing.
Anyways, yeah, that's pretty much where we are. Nowadays, very few people are still around from the original days. There's still Matt, or Beachy, and sure. Hazer. Yep. Beachy, by the way, is the guy who we basically used as the avatar for a whole little mod gate thing.
Yeah. You know what? Maybe it would be good to sort of give a little more background on that. You know, you mentioned Modgate. We saw that it sort of coincided with the Panda Lee situation. But from what I'm to understand, it wasn't directly spurred by the actual Panda Lee Modgate situation. Well, I guess you can call it Modgate on her behalf because she was a Twitch mod. But it wasn't actually directly linked with each other.
It wasn't linked at all. Well, never mind. There was directly, a very minor. It wasn't even indirectly linked, I don't think.
There's a very minor link to it, though. It occurred in a thread where Panda Lee was mentioned. That's about it.
I'm sorry. I'm looking in the chat, and one of the names is Fanta Chugger. I'm sorry. I was looking at the viewers list, and the first thing I see in the name is Fanta Chugger.
Why is that funny?
I don't know why. I just saw that and I was just like laughing really fucking hard. I guess I think it's a reference obviously to when DSP was talking saying something to that one guy that was playing Deathstroke and Injustice. He's like telling him to go to his basement or whatever, and Doritos and Fanta, yeah. But I guess that's where that guy got the name from. And I just find that name really funny. Anyway, sorry about that.
Yeah, let's get back to focusing on the guests. Sorry that you cut you off.
Different standards on what's funny.
It's simply a reference.
Yeah, it's pretty much a reference. I don't know why. I just laugh at the stupidest shit, though. But anyway, go on.
Sly's just being difficult.
Yeah, Sly.
Would you like to start with this, Sly, or should I?
Go ahead.
All right. It occurred in a thread where Panda Lee was being mentioned, and she was not being insulted. She was just receiving criticism, and Phil didn't like that. Phil doesn't like it when people talk about his girlfriend on the forums, which everyone kind of knows at this point. So he ended up closing the thread indiscriminately, not allowing the topic to continue. It wasn't the thread itself, but Phil's actions that set us off, basically.
And there were actions preceding this that led to it. It wasn't just that.
He attempted to delete the criticism thread, and we just brought that right back. Wow. Because he didn't.
Oh, boy.
I mean, I'm going to be transparent about it, Sly. You know, it might be secretive, but he attempted to do it.
Do I look like the kind of person who's going to stop you from telling the truth?
Not at all. So, yes, we couldn't directly pin it on Phil, mainly because we couldn't see who had done it. However, Beachy and Hazer could, and they told us that he did. So we brought it back immediately.
Despite we brought the fact it back before he told us.
Yeah. We brought it back immediately because, first of all, there was no reason given. Nothing was said. And you don't delete a thread that big without saying anything.
Right. I believe I noticed that I think it got taken down and somebody posted a thread, like the version 2.0 type of thing. And I think it was Slyspy that actually came in and was like, what's going on here? I wasn't even aware that the thread was deleted.
Yeah, like it's very difficult to notice unless someone says something. But when it was said, I was like, what? So I went through the logs of all the deleted threads. Thank goodness it wasn't permanently deleted. And I just pulled it back up and slided it at the same time, but I still say it was me that did it.
Yeah, okay, son.
So it seems kind of weird that he received a criticism thread about his girlfriend's antics, and then he sort of maybe had a little bit of an overreaction and deleted the criticism thread wholesale?
Yeah, he... For a little while before this, we began to notice, specifically, DSP.text brought it up to me that he showed me some images of Phil saying that he's going to come cracking down on the forums from now on.
Yep, I remember those.
By being more harsh and throwing the rules to the reckless abandoned wind.
I believe he said any sort of negativity he's getting rid of.
Yes. What? Something. You could be paraphrasing, but...
Isn't the point of having a forum, though, like to accept criticism in a way?
It's just to have a free flow of...
exchange of ideas.
Yeah. And I don't know. It's just really weird to kind of shut down the negativity or any kind of criticism that he gets. But yeah, anyway, carry on.
After that, Phil was getting a bit defensive. To the point where he insulted, I believe, two members, and that's when I said, that's enough. I edited his post, I made it very apparent that I edited his post, and I asked him nicely to not do it again. I also attempted to give him a warning, and I couldn't, so that's when the whole discussion started. I spoke with Hazer and Beachy, and I just asked them why I couldn't warn Phil, and they're like, well, that's strange, we never thought about that. And apparently you can't warn moderators or admins, which kind of bothers me, to be honest. But that has nothing to do with the forum. It has everything to do with the makeup of the forum. What's the word I'm searching for?
The community.
No, not the community.
He's talking about the technical aspect.
Yes. The technical aspects of the forums don't allow us to warn.
It doesn't matter, though. You could, I mean...
Oh, you mean the infrastructure.
I don't even give out warnings. I give out verbal warnings, so it's whatever.
Yeah, I'm a bit more less interactive with the community when it comes to that. If someone does something wrong, they just get a warning from me anyways.
And just to cut on just 1 second, just for the sake of clarity, the actual quote that we were talking about, I have right here, quote, "I'm starting to clean house on the forums and on here. No more tolerance for people who just talk to be negative. I'll explain everything on the pre-stream." So just for the sake of clarity.
Oh, by the way, I remember that pre-stream. He didn't explain.
Exactly. Yep.
It was really disappointing. I was like, oh, I gotta hear this. Oh, I didn't know. Anyways, after that, we began talking, and this small talk somehow took in all of the moderators and the entire staff, and we all just started discussing this, and we decided we didn't like where the owner was going with the forum. It's sort of a disagreement between management and proprietor. After that, well, 12 pages of discussion later, we eventually came upon the decision to make a little message for Phil and that we would, at that point, no longer be moderating his forum. And what happened within the first hour was, to be said, quite bad. Lots of spam posts started popping up. Lots of really negative posts started popping up, and we didn't do anything about that.
Well, let's not forget this was... really bad timing on, I guess, for Phil, because he was having a giveaway at that point, so a lot of new members were coming in. That's why a lot of stuff was coming out.
Mm-hmm. And to be honest, not to sound like an opportunist or anything, I somewhat am, but not to that extent, I kind of chose to do this right around the time when Phil was actually going to need us the most to be checking IPs, that being his giveaway. So he had to notice.
Right, because that does actually take manpower to be able to check IPs for duplicate entries.
Yeah, I do. I believe I might be doing the majority of the IP checking because the rest of the moderating staff doesn't have access to the CP. However, Hazer and Matt do, but I doubt they actually use it.
So you are the infamous algorithm.
I wouldn't put it that way.
He has several times. He said that his mods are going to be using algorithms to detect fraud.
Yeah, algorithms. I pushed a button. Do you have another account? No. Okay, you're good.
Very nice.
Such badass over here.
I know. You guys got the semen database that you can check. Sorry, CSI joke. So anyway, sorry to cut you off. So basically, you guys coincided it with the giveaway, and then you guys had some clear intentions. So you were going to just sort of maybe go on a little bit more on the rationale behind it, and then maybe after we can start to get into how it built up.
Actually, any comments on the last discussion, Sly? I noticed you didn't say much.
You pretty much summed it up. I'm not going to add to it.
All right. Now, why we did it? Well, the reason is pretty obvious. It isn't because things Phil does off of the forums. If Phil wanted to beat somebody with a cat, and that cat just died, you know, along with the person that he was beating, and he wanted to put this in a video, go for it. You're going to get arrested. But
sure.
If he posts that video on the forum, then I have a problem with it. That's the only thing I care about, to be honest. In this situation, in that regard, anyways.
Well, within the context of being a moderator, that's really all you got to worry about.
Exactly. Several times people have come on to the forum or left comments in videos saying, Phil did this off of the forum. Why isn't he not being punished?
Or on Twitter. On Twitter.
Oh, my God. I love Twitter.
Yeah, I mean, I think Twitter is probably the most ineffective for actually affecting change in that way.
Speaking of change, we're kind of forcing change, aren't we? It doesn't feel right.
Well, I mean, you guys took a strong stance, and you know, obviously, his actions weren't very honorable. I guess you could say they weren't really fitting with your system of ethics and your commitment to the community, more so than just like his fans. But what I'm really getting here is an overlying theme: is that you guys are committed to the community as a group of people.
Something like that, yes.
I wouldn't put it as dramatically, but yeah.
Well, we're on a podcast, so let's Hollywood it up, right?
I like to think of it like this. Let's say the forum is our house. If someone's going to start flinging shit all around the block, but they miss our house, I'm fine. Huh. If they hit the house, that's when I'm going to take action.
I like that.
I think that's the best way I could possibly describe it. If someone wants to throw shit at Twitter's house or YouTube's house, they can take care of it. It's not my job.
YouTube has poor janitors.
Oh, yeah.
So you guys basically wanted more accountability out of Phil. And I think everybody did. I think that fans and detractors alike both were aiming for just a little bit more accountability out of Phil, because it seemed as though he would have this very dismissive attitude that it's my business and I can run it the way I want to. Did you guys have things that were also building up that you saw that sort of chipped away at your guys' composure when it comes to this kind of thing?
Well, we pretty much mentioned it. It's him cracking down on threads, deleting posts. He didn't like if they were overly negative. That's pretty much what it was. Yeah, insulting members.
My least favorite thing, and this, I came up with this particular term, is his penchant for creating shadow rules. Rules that are unwritten, that he's making up on the spot, and punishing people for doing before he even invented the rule. Let's say you're climbing a tree, and while you're in the tree, somebody created a law that you're not allowed to climb trees. Already in the tree, so you're going to be punished for it.
Right.
That's what I'm talking about. I don't like that.
Right. So I guess chief among them would be the Panda Lee rule. Rule 10, is if we'll put it.
Rule 10 doesn't seem to exist anymore as of late. I like that. criticism threads regarding Pandalia have, you know, staggered a bit over time, considering she's no longer a mod. You're welcome, Internet, by the way. Signed, the King of Hate Staff. But, yeah, there are still threads now and then, like, why do you not allow her to speak in your DSV Tries It videos? That's an assumption. She probably just doesn't want to talk. And if she did, I'm pretty sure she would say, okay, Phil, if you listen, please don't hurt me.
So, you mentioned the Pandalia fiasco. What sort of made it important for you guys to sort of minimize her role? Because she was sort of, when I look at interactions on the Twitch board, and I know you guys aren't as involved in Twitch, but just in general, I've noticed that she sort of ranks above everyone else. So it seems like people like Drill and stuff like that actually have to ask her for permission in order to do things. And I would have to assume if she was involved in the forums, it would be the same. So what made it so important to sort of minimize her role?
She actually used to be a mod on the forums, believe it or not. They were vanilla forums. And
was she? I remember being regular.
She was only a mod for her particular section, which gave her very little power, considering nobody posted there.
Oh, I got you.
However, it has nothing to do with my history with Pandalia. Pandalia, we used to be good buddies, I guess you could say, you know, somewhat acquaintances. We used to have these little, you know, playful discussions. And then she decided that she hated me one day because I told her not to insult people on the forums. She called somebody retarded. Anyways, I'm digressing. The reason why we decided to make her role so insignificant, or more insignificant than it was due to the fact that it would probably be in Phil's best interest, considering he doesn't like people talking about his girlfriend on the forums right in front of him. If Pandalia isn't a mod, people have less reason to talk about her, if you see what I'm saying.
Sure.
And that other thing too, sorry to interject, but it was clear he had bias toward her, you know, that he wasn't going to be able to hold her accountable completely. So it was just better off that he didn't make her a mod anyway, so he wouldn't have to put himself in that position.
And if she, basically it works like this. If people are talking about Pandalia and Phil doesn't like that, he gets stressed. Everyone gets stressed. But you can lessen that stress by just not having her be a mod. People talk about her less, you feel less stress. There you go. Not only is it better for the community, because we are kind of getting tired of those threads anyways, it's better for Phil.
Oh, of course. Of course. I mean, it'll make his content better for his fans. You know, he won't be so quick to explode on things, even though I think that to an extent that is part of his allure. I think that his angry sort of persona when he gets into certain games. So, for example, that's why his Metal Gear Solid playthroughs are that much more popular, is because they know that they're going to get some sort of reaction out of him. But in general, you can't really have that across the board. It has to be special. It has to be something that isn't just, oh, he's just mad at every single game, because those people already exist.
I agree. Stress, I want to bring up real quick, I think plays into his whole attitude with cracking down on the forum, because he was so, we had had talks with him a little bit, where he talked about he was getting stressed seeing all this negativity on the forum, and he felt like it was getting out of control. And the whole forum was going to turn into this negative thing about him. He didn't realize that there was, for every topic being negative toward him, there's like 10 other topics you're not reading that are just fine.
Exactly. And
he's figuratively remembering the slap, basically.
Exactly. And when we took that stand against him, and you know, to his credit, he was malleable on the situation. He did say he's no longer going to involve himself that heavily in the forum, where he's going to moderate people. He's going to let us do it. And you've been seeing the results of that right now. There ain't no mass hysteria going on in the forum. Ain't 100 negative topics going on. It's probably less negative than it was last month.
I would have to say so. It's sort of a you tell people they can't do something and they're going to try to do it sort of thing. And now that the proverbial floodgates are now open, you've got people like myself, Loophole, you know, other people that have joined the forums based on the, you know, sort of assurance that we're not just going to get banned for no reason. And as long as we're operating within the rules, I feel like I've been able to produce some positive threads. I know that creating the threads about this show has actually helped in getting you on and also Slyspy and stuff like that. So I feel like whether you're a fan or whether you're a bit more critical of him, a former fan, there's a benefit to being able to express yourself freely in that medium, because like I said, Twitter is so many characters and you don't want to flood 17 tweets just to get your message out.
Well, the forum has always been open for anybody who wants to join. I mean, I know Evil AJ was a part of the vanilla forums. I know Kane Bring the Pain was also part of the vanilla forums. I know there was someone else. I can't think of them right now, but they've always been open for that, and they've always followed the rules, and that's why they were so welcomed on the forums in the first place. Like, Evil AJ has never once said a spiteful thing on the forums. On the forums, though. He said some spiteful shit before, though. Calling you out.
So you kind of mentioned that he's seeming a little more stressed. Would you guys at all say, because obviously you guys have some interactions with him outside of what he says publicly, where maybe he sort of sets his agenda or kind of sets the tone as what he's going for in terms of moderation. Would you guys say that the move has at all affected him in terms of his stress level and in terms of his desire to sort of squash negativity and further his business?
I would say so, you know. I mean, logically, think about it. The dude doesn't have any friends near him anymore. He doesn't have his family near him anymore. He's on his own. He's with his girl. He's trying to get himself, you know, he's trying to get himself right. So he's not wanting to mess up. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, he's built quite the tower of dishes that he's now standing on top of, and he doesn't want them all to smash beneath him. So he's going to have to pull off quite the balancing act.
Of course, because he's taken it, you know, he's taken it to a certain excess to get himself a fairly expensive house, completely supporting himself and one other person who is qualified but unwilling to work, at least at this time. So it does seem like he is sort of getting himself into a bit bigger of a commitment than he was prepared for, and now he's sort of feeling the effects of that. Again, do you guys really believe in the notion that any criticism would affect his business? Because it seems as though he feels as though any negative connotation or any criticism toward him is chipping away at his credibility and his business and his ability to make money on YouTube and on Twitch.
I think the only negative criticism, and by negative criticism, I'm referring to unfair criticism, and there is some of that out there. But I think the only time that it would actually chip away at him is when bigger names do it, you know, Slow Beef. Nowadays, Evil AJ, despite having a low subscriber count, he still has plenty of viewers. That's bullshit, or am I even pronouncing that correctly?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, big names like that. Also, two best friends, but they don't really talk about him as much as they just mock him for like a few seconds, laugh about it, pat themselves on the back, and continue being bad at games. And after that, what do you got? You got Phil thinking that because, you know, these few big names are out there talking, you know, quote unquote, shit about him, he believes that everybody is. And sure, he might, you know, have some evidence that everybody is by going on Twitter of all places. Ugh. But he completely, like Sly said earlier, he completely overlooks anything positive just to focus on the negative. He could shake 1,000 hands and get slapped once in a day, but he'd only remember the slap.
I think he's coming around and seeing it, though. You know, I don't think there's as many, as I said, there's not as much negativity anymore. So he might be seeing what we was trying to tell him before.
I actually have a question. I don't think it's really relevant at this point, but I wanted to ask anyway. Do you still watch Phil's content, or do you just, like, continue to moderate his stream and, like, not watch his content at all? Like, are you on track with what he does now?
Sly and I are not stream mods, by the way, but... I only watch his content when he has an eye-catching title or if it's posted in the funniest moments thread. That's pretty much...
Okay. Well, I'm not asking if you're stream mods. I know you guys are forum mods.
All right.
But I wasn't sure if you actually watched their content, like, or watch his content, like, at all as of recent.
Not as religiously as I used to. Go ahead, Sly.
Occasionally I do. I haven't seen too many too often lately, but I have an off and on thing where I'm at one point I'll be watching a lot of his content, and at one point I'm taking a break. I'm kind of in the middle right now. I'm keeping up with his Parasite Eve playthrough, but little by little I'm watching his Alien Isolation playthrough.
Okay, that's all I need to know. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
I believe the last video of his I watched was the final boss of Bayonetta 2, mainly because I just wanted to see how he does. He ended up using a lot of items, which I can only determine to be a bad thing. But
I have a question for you people. Do any of you actually actively watch his content, or?
I guess I'll take that one first. I used to. I was a fan back in 2008, and I slowly started not to. I will watch a playthrough that I'm guaranteed to sort of get that rage, instant gratification sort of thing. So the last one that I watched, and I didn't watch the majority of it, but I tried to catch the Resident Evil 3 because I knew there was going to be a lot of shenanigans. And that's sort of what I like to see in Phil. I still find humor in someone legitimately being angry and upset at a video game and expressing that sort of frustration. And I think Phil is a good character for that. I think that maybe he is milking it a bit, but I think that his mannerisms, his catchphrases that he uses in these certain situations, I still sort of find humor in them. But something else, just like a general game, like say he's going to play The Last of Us, or say he's going to play Sunset Overdrive or something like that, I don't have any interest whatsoever.
Oh, you don't have any interest in Sunset Overdrive either?
Him playing it, but yeah, I get what you mean.
Well, I can answer this question because I can tell you that I don't oftenly watch any of his new content. The last thing I watched from him was Resident Evil 3. Like, I only watched, like, a little bit of it because I got really bored. But that's, like, the last time I ever really, like, followed his stuff. Other than that, like, I'm just doing other things. And I see everyone on Twitter really mostly talking about it. So Twitter just, like, keeps me up to date about it.
I'm in the same boat as Fred. Exactly what Fred said is exactly how I feel on your question.
Same here. So it's mainly you watch him for, like, the failures and stuff.
Right.
For the most part.
For the humor. Okay. Because, honestly, his brand of humor has gotten a little stale. The whole, take your top off, that kind of stuff isn't very funny. I'm not a fan of his Hate Live really anymore. So just him talking generally, it's more him reacting to something. And usually when it's a frustrating game, that's when it's going to be entertaining, because he's going to react to it in the most over the top and, short-sighted way possible.
See, generally for me, the thing I always liked about Phil was, especially at the time when I first saw him, there was a lot of Let's Plays who were just, like, bored. They didn't seem like they were interested in the game. And with Phil, when you watch his video, there was a certain level of enthusiasm he brought to it where, again, when you talk about the anger and the fails, that's enthusiasm. That says that he actually cares about what he's doing at the time. And I even liked his, positive playthroughs where he wasn't that angry for that reason as well as, you know, the failures.
See, I somewhat agree with what you just said, that back in the day, yeah. But when you look at modern times, nowadays, there's so many other people who've grown and...
There's a lot of people who are
all this stuff more enthusiastic. That he's, and his sense of humor, It's like he's not growing. He's the same person he was with the same sense of humor, and it's just, it doesn't work anymore. The way I kind of sort of look at it, this is not, this is kind of a good analogy, is that I view him as cassette tapes when CDs are the new hot technology. You know what I mean?
That's fair.
You know, it's like he's just, he's struggling to just be relevant with the times, and he's just not helping his own case by, like I said, his sense of humor, the certain jokes that push the limit of very childish nature. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I feel you.
So that's my stance on him, the way I look at him.
For me, I never really watched a lot of his gameplay. It was mostly his vlogs. That's what I mostly watched. If I watched Phil regularly, it would be, I'd turn the vlogs on, I'd play something, I'd listen to whatever he said in the background. I used to like the Hateful Truth reviews a lot, because I just felt like he gave a different opinion, and I didn't always agree with it, but I thought it was mostly interesting to hear, and it was background noise, but some of his other blogs I thought were entertaining. But the gameplay just got stale very fast. I don't think I've watched a really long playthrough ever from him, because it just gets boring after a while. That's my view on how much I watch him. Not that much.
All right.
Anybody else?
Yes, I don't like Phil at all. I really want him to die.
We'll make sure to edit that out. Now, this isn't live or anything. So you guys sort of mentioned that you were former fans. Was there any particular moment or playthrough or anything that sort of turned you off to his content? Of course, in the sexual sense.
Normally, this is the part where someone would expect at least one of us, you know, 50% of the people got turned off by the playthrough I'm about to mention, Assassin's Creed 3. No, that wasn't me. So, I actually watched the entirety of Assassin's Creed, and there's actually one really good moment in it between Phil and Pandalee where she's, you know, talking about how cute an animal is, and Phil runs up the steps. I thought that was wonderful. But for me, the playthrough that turned me off was probably the last one that I watched some of the way through and just got bored. Thief. And don't get me wrong, there was a really funny moment in Thief, what's the third event schedule. In fact, Thief in general is just a really funny game, unintentionally. But that's my answer.
But the question is, what playthroughs have turned me off from Phil, you say?
Right. So was there some sort of moment, or was there a playthrough that sort of struck a chord with you, or you were like, maybe that moment of realization, like, maybe this isn't really the guy I want to be watching?
Not really. Like I said before, my whole thing, yeah, I'm echoing over here.
Oh, we've got it taken care of. Sorry about that.
All right, my whole thing is like I said before, it's just an on and off thing. I just lose interest after a while, because it's just, you know, I'm used to Phil. I know what he does, so I might not be in the mood for him, and eventually I lose interest. That's all. I'll say this though. Early on, when I used to watch Phil, when I was first watching him, that side to him, the first playthrough I seen of him was Heavy Rain. So my impression of him kind of gave me that impression that all of his playthroughs were kind of like that. And the one I saw that made me realize he has, you know, more flaws to him was when I saw his Assassin's Creed 2 playthrough, when I discovered that, he blames the games for his own mistakes and, you know, stuff like that. But it didn't turn me off to him. It just that I saw another side to the whole thing.
I have a question in return, though, for everyone. Does anyone have a favorite playthrough of Phil's?
Mine is actually Limbo.
Heavy Rain. That's what got me into watching him.
For me, it was Spider-Man Web of Shadows. That's the first play that I saw of him when I looked him up.
Oh, I should add TV Superstars. Yeah, exactly. That's easily that my one. Favorite co-op with John Rambo.
Yeah, it's probably mine.
TV no, Superstars. Honestly, mine was the first one I ever watched, Resistance 2.
Oh. I'd have to say for me, it was the first one that I watched. It was Fallout 3, his original Fallout 3 DLC. He did the pit. I was actually trying to find some video walkthroughs on how to get through the pit, and I stumbled onto his, and I was treated to a very inebriated gentleman who was reacting poorly at everything, and I just thought it was great. And from then, I watched the rest of it, watched the rest of the DLC, and yeah, the rest is history there. Recently, I actually really enjoyed his Vice City Stories playthrough. I know it was full of rage and stuff like that, but I really enjoyed the game as a whole, so I enjoyed seeing him go through it. And the bits where he did have, you know, sort of prolonged antics was enjoyable for me.
I recall Phil getting quite intoxicated during his Fallout 3 playthrough, specifically when he got really drunk and decided to shoot people inside of Big Town.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah, so that was sort of the thing that started it all, in my opinion, that sort of put him over the top for me, was the Fallout 3 playthroughs. I came in a little late. Obviously, I came in for the Pit DLC, so I had to go back and see the original Fallout 3 playthrough. But yeah, that was around the time for me, and that's when I really enjoyed his content.
And speaking of that, we all know that Phil doesn't like to edit out his content at all. And repeated fails can become annoying, but there is one series of fails which stretched over the course of several videos, actually, longer than normal videos anyways, where I thought it was actually pretty funny to watch him progress and try to get to the Declaration of Independence in Fallout 3. He got his ass kicked a lot.
Yeah, he did.
So many saves.
Yeah. See, now the whole unediting thing, I sort of looked at it from a different angle. So I had a specific angle. I didn't want to spend as much money to buy all these games. So sometimes, other than just completely skip a game or rent it, I would watch a playthrough of it, and that would be him. And because he wasn't editing, and because he was just basically, this was before he was streaming, so it was a little less instant, but because he was just uploading them in mass and not editing them, he would get them up right away. And that was something that I in particular liked at that time specifically, because I wasn't going out and buying all the games. I was a bit younger, I was just starting out in college, so I was like, I don't really want to spend all this money and commit all this money to all these games, and I don't have as much time, blah, so I can just get part of them. Yeah. So from that specific point of view, as someone who was watching playthroughs instead of buying games in certain cases, I was actually happy that he wasn't editing, because he was able to get them up quicker. Now that he streams, obviously it's a little bit different, because you get the unedited version when he streams, and then you can get the edited version when he uploads it to YouTube if he was going to edit.
I gotcha.
Can I interject real quick?
Go for it.
My bad. I would say the other thing about Phil that made his name, because you just mentioned that, was it's kind of the analogy of fast food. You know what I'm saying? Like, some people want to wait for their burger or whatever, but the appeal of McDonald's is that when it first came out, it's a lot of burgers immediately, and that's kind of what his playthroughs were. You get all the parts. You don't have to wait a day for like two parts to watch. You just got them all, and you can watch them at your own pace.
Does anyone else get the feeling that if Phil were to become like 500, 600,000 subscribers, huge on YouTube, his video count would actually decrease over time? Does anyone get that feeling? Because he wouldn't have to put in as much effort anymore. He could just make a 20-minute video and post it up and be done.
I don't think he'd change that at all. Nope.
I think you would see it as more money.
Exactly.
I think what Phil should do is he should continue with his full playthroughs, just because that's how he made his name. That's what people know him for. But at the same time, just as an option, he should have highlights at the end of every playthrough. So you get a montage. You don't have to watch it if you don't want to. You don't have to watch the whole thing.
Or just hire Evil AJ to do it for him, and you know, he could have the video, he could pay AJ.
That was a good idea that someone made, that he would pay a little bit of money to people who make montages for him, because they're doing his work, and I mean...
And in exchange, he'd get to keep the video.
Yeah.
Yeah. Didn't he already say he wanted to do something like that in terms of a montage? I forgot what it was for.
It was for
Destiny. He said that, yeah, Destiny.
Destiny, yeah.
Never did the montage of Suicide Kings 2.0, though. That really disappointed me.
Oh, yeah, he was supposed to do that for Grand Theft Auto 5, but never done it.
Yeah.
He said it was too, I don't know, he said it was too intrusive how it was supposed to be done, and he couldn't get a lot of people on board for it, so he decided to say, fuck it.
It wasn't as conducive to, like, a funny suicide thing as Red Dead was, because Red Dead had a bunch of clips and stuff you could, you know, drive off of.
In GTA 5, he said that it was too much to set up, too much time-consuming shit, so he decided to drop it.
One thing about I never understood about the Suicide Kings in the first place was why people found falling John Marston or whoever was so funny. Because it really kills the moment when the person falls and they hit the ground, and then the camera stays where they hit, but they go off camera and you can't see them anymore. That kind of ruins the humor of it, in my opinion.
I gotta be honest with you. I heard of the Suicide Kings, but I never actually watched it. I heard all the hype and, oh, this is such a great video with me and Rambo, and, oh, you definitely gotta watch it. And I actually never actually got around to watching it, so I can't comment too much on that series.
I actually believe the Suicide Kings was one of the only videos Phil has ever had featured on YouTube, which actually was pretty interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Huh. That video got... featured? Wasn't it like cursing and stuff?
So what?
Wasn't it like profanity? Like videos that have profanity can't get featured?
Oh, there was never that rule.
No, there was no rule on that on YouTube. You could like say the F word every 5 seconds and the video would still get featured on YouTube.
Yeah.
Sometimes it could be counted as someone's style of humor or the way they talk. But it's not like they're verbally harassing someone and shit. YouTube would never like put shit like that on their feature page.
Yeah.
No.
I also remember
YouTube feature welcome to YouTube.
Oh yeah, the that.
But they didn't allow that guy to have ads on.
Are you talking about
Jello
the,
Apocalypse?
I was gonna say, are you talking about the Bo Burnham stuff? I don't remember.
I'm talking about the welcome. There's a video called Welcome to YouTube, which sarcastically goes over all of YouTube's flaws.
Oh, I was gonna say.
And that got featured on YouTube, but YouTube never allowed that video to have ads. Oh. They were so hurt about that.
Yeah, when you say Welcome to YouTube, I think of that one thing that Bo Burnham did at YouTube Live, and like basically made a song from the top of his head at the event, and it was pretty damn funny. I would look it up when you have the chance to. It's pretty damn funny. But yeah,
I'd recommend looking up the video on that.
Yeah,
Bo Burnham did something that's actually funny.
Yep, he's white, he can't be funny.
Oh, come on now.
I said nothing to do with him being white, he's just not funny.
But anyway,
some really popular comedians really just turn me off entirely. I know for, you know, not really a fact, but Sly thinks George Carlin is overrated.
No, I like George Carlin. I don't dislike him.
You just don't like it when people quote him.
Yeah, that's what it is. The pretentiousness of quoting him and acting like you some kind of intellectual genius. I like Carlin though.
Alright. What question were we on, by the way?
Well, basically we were having you guys ask us a few questions, and I was about to just, you know, extend the invitation if you guys have any questions, because obviously we asked a lot of questions of you guys to sort of get to know you and give the listeners a good impression of you. If you guys have any questions for us, we'd be happy to have them, and, you know, while you guys are thinking of them, or if you guys have one right now, we could either do that or we'll continue on.
The rumor mill, you know it exists, but...
Oh, of course.
Have you heard any about the forums in general?
Any rumors about the forums?
You know, like we treat people unfairly or anything regarding that?
to be honest, the impression that I have is now that, see, before the whole thing happened with Modgate, whatever you want to call it, you guys taking a stand, going on strike. Maybe I'll refer to it as you guys went on strike. After you guys went on strike,
use Modgate.
Okay, fine. After Modgate, the reputation changed, obviously. But I think before, the reputation was that you guys were specifically just drones for Phil. And this is maybe people that weren't actually participating, or maybe people that had that notion and chose not to participate and couldn't see for themselves. But I think that the general consensus with a lot of people was that you guys were drones for Phil. You guys were employees of Phil, diehard fans, and you guys were just there to squash negativity full board.
Well, first of all, let me state that we are not obligated at all to defend Phil, and more often than not, we don't. Moving on from that, Sly?
I'd defend Phil if he's worth defending. If I think he's wrong, then he's wrong.
Exactly.
To me. And there's proof of this on the forum. You could go right now.
Weren't you attacked for being a quote-unquote fanboy? Because you said it's perfectly fine to joke about anything, and I'm actually in agreement with you there. It is fine to joke about anything.
To see, when I made that post about it's fine to joke about anything, Phil got mad at me for making that post. Really? He got mad at me, but people are calling me a fanboy. Yeah, because Phil didn't think it's all right to make, you know, fun of people, individuals, but it's okay to make fun of, like, you know, groups, because he doesn't approve of, I guess, personal attacks or whatever.
I'm actually in agreement, like, with Phil, almost. I like to make fun of Catholics.
But you know what I'm saying, like, if you're making fun of your friends, that's personal, but you're not being, like, mean, it's all in good fun.
I gotcha. And like I said, I don't think any topic is too moot to be discussed or joked about. Let's see, what other questions could I possibly conjure up?
Yeah, anything really. You know, obviously you guys are more of the, obviously you're staff, we can't escape the fact that you are staff members for Phil, even though if your actual mission is for the community, it's still a Phil forum. So because you guys haven't taken the step to go off and have another forum, no matter how you frame it, you guys still are employees of Phil, or keeping the machine running for Phil. So I guess in that sense, people would perceive you as being part of the Phil supporters. So as sort of the critics that we are, you know, we'd be open to any sort of questions like that.
Oh, speaking of...
I'd say we're more volunteers. Employees get paid.
Oh, definitely. If I was getting paid for this, I'd censor the shit out of anything.
All right, but actually, I do have one question for you guys. Sorry to cut you off if you weren't done. You said you spoke to Phil, like privately about the forums and all that stuff, right?
We attempted to, but eventually...
A little bit.
He lost interest in the topic, so we never got
to respond. But you have, at one point, like, yes, had conversation with him? My flat-out question would be is... Well, I have two questions. One, is there any difference between his public image, the way he portrays himself on stream, YouTube, Twitter, all that stuff, and the way he talks to you guys?
Sly?
He's pretty honest, I guess. I mean,
well,
meaning, like, he's not, you know, I don't think he's a phony or nothing, but I mean, I don't really know. I've heard people say talking to him personally he's nicer in person or whatever, but I can't really say. Like, the conversations we've had with him were, for the most part, initiated by himself, so.
Yes.
If
I were to determine one difference between Phil's public image and his image that he publicly shows on the forum, and the image that he displays for us privately in the moderation or the staff discussion, I'd suppose
he's a bit more genuine. He's willing to basically admit that he's in a weak state. He's stressed out. He doesn't feel like dealing with X or Y, and he doesn't know why things are happening the way they are. He doesn't act that way on the forums or in videos, to my knowledge, but he shows off a more sensitive side, I guess you could say.
As a follow-up to what you just said, do you think, because me personally, I agree with what I'm about to say, don't you think that if he was more honest about that type of stuff with his public image, that would go a long way with people's views upon him?
Honestly don't, because...
No.
Basically, people would consider him playing the victim.
Exactly. See, if he was to come out publicly... Let me explain. See, this thing, the stuff that he says publicly already, when he used to talk about certain things, people already used to say he was bitching about stuff. If he was to come out and say that he was getting stressed out because of his situation, trust me, people would find a way to turn that against him.
But me being an ex-fan of his, I would view that, especially given all the shit he gets, I would view that as him being a stand-up guy and being, you know what, this is where I'm at, this is where my mind's at, this is what, like you said, this is what mistakes I've made or so forth, so on. And I just wanted to be honest with you guys. I'm not asking for this, I'm not asking for that, but I just wanted to let you know where my mindset's at. I would take that as a step in the right direction, as a positive thing.
You know, maybe you would, but like, again, this stuff he's already said, where if he comes out and talks about things, people would try to turn it against him. When he would talk about how his views were going down, people were like, oh, all you care about is money and this and that. So I guess we're gonna have to agree to disagree on this matter.
There are so many algorithms out there, so many individuals who do not like Phil, who practically hate him. Which, by the way, hate's a bit of a strong word, considering it's a guy on the internet. Just throwing that out there.
All right, and my second question I actually had for you originally was, it's a very blunt question. Do you think he's an egotistical type of person?
He has some tendencies, yes.
Sly?
Do I think he's egotistical? Yeah. A little bit.
Like, what? Describe why you say he is. I just want to hear you guys what your opinions are.
He had the audacity to go against the guidelines that the staff had. That's for sure.
Okay. And besides that?
Besides that, one phrase that he likes to use so very often is how great his views used to be, how great things are, or how good he is at something. That's the general consensus for me, is that when he likes to brag, it comes off as egotistical. It comes off as showy.
There's also a sense of, what you call it, like double standard, you would say. Like, there would be certain people he would look at, and he would not view other people's actions as acceptable, even if he did the same thing. And I think part of it is his ego plays into it. I don't think it's necessarily malicious, but it's just something he's very oblivious about sometimes.
Although, to be fully honest with you, the phrase ego is thrown around so often on the forums, it just doesn't have meaning to me anymore. Sort of like the word hypocrite. What is a hypocrite anyway?
Yeah.
Everybody's a hypocrite.
And hater, and hipster.
Everybody is a hypocrite, but I've been a hypocrite with things in life. Pretty much everybody has, like you said. I agree with that. But Phil does it publicly. That's my issue with him and the word hypocrite, is he'll say one thing, do another, so constantly that it becomes a running joke in my mind. It really does. You know, I'm not saying this to insult him, you guys, for being associated with him, but it's a truth. It's documented with his videos. You know, like, I don't have any clear cut examples in my head, so I'm sorry I can't give it.
I understand.
But he does that constantly, and it's. And he denies it, which is the thing that which fucks with my mind, is that he denies it every single time. Like, I don't think there's one moment that he's ever admitted, listen, I said this, I'm sorry I said it, but this is what I really mean. You know, it's like he'll just say, "Oh, that never happened." What are you talking about?
I think on one of his podcasts, actually, he did come out and like apologize that sometimes he gets hot air and, you know,
yeah, I remember that.
Says shit he doesn't think about. So, yeah. I mean, for now, you just got to try to hold him to a standard. You know, he's saying he's trying to change or whatever. So we just got to hold him to that standard. And if he messes up, you know, let him know he messed up.
Well, we do. People do. And he denies it.
I hold myself to a certain standard as well. I have a little, a little objective for me in life, basically. It's never quote or hold somebody to the word when they spoke it in anger. If you do that, you only come across as an opportunist who's trying to take advantage of somebody's emotion.
I agree with what you just said, but I don't think Phil ever does that.
But some of the people who are against Phil don't do that either.
How so?
Well, you've seen it, man. Whenever you would be angry about something and spout out hot air about something because he was angry at the time, people would put that in their little in their Rolodex and then bring it up like 2 years later. You know what I'm saying?
And I'm actually in agreement with Sly there. Recall the incident that occurred at an SGC event or FGC event where Phil was disqualified for bringing his camera.
Mm-hmm.
He got upset, and you know what? That was used. It was used like butter on bread.
I would say that it wasn't exactly the quotes that he said. I would say it was the situation that he got himself into. He was choosing to record before he was angry. He was choosing to continue to record while he was given the warning before he was angry. What actually made him angry was the fact that he was disqualified for something that he felt that he was not doing wrong. And then in anger, he said, "Where am I playing? You still haven't told me yet. You want me to run your tournament for you?" And I don't think that those two quotes that he said in anger were exactly used against him in that vein. I think specifically what people found humor in and what people found fault in him for is that he was making such a spectacle of himself recording. He was actually holding up the tournament to the extent that some unbiased, I would say, what are they, the referees, the officials of the tournament, actually disqualified him for it. Those things he didn't do in anger.
I don't know. He seemed irrational.
No, I understand, but I'm just saying as far as discounting something because he was angry when he did it, I would say that the main things that people took away from that is that he was recording to that extent, and then afterwards he got angry. But the exact quotes that he said, I don't think those are exactly the ammunition as you describe them.
So as you're attempting to tell me is people aren't upset with what he said, it's the fact that he had the audacity to hold up the tournament because he was upset.
It's no. He had the audacity to hold up the tournament by his self-importance of needing to record it.
All right, I follow you.
And that in no way was that fueled by anger.
If I can jump in real quick, I think, to be honest with you, I think the biggest problem with Phil is that maybe in the past or in the future or whatever, present, I think it was his consistent bad attitude. I mean, obviously, I think he has anger issues, but you know what? You know, he has to control it. You know, it's just like working a job. You go in there, you have a bad day. People won't shit on you for it. But if you're constantly going in there with a bad attitude, then rightfully so, you're going to be looked at. I guess you can say you're going to be looked at unjustly or whatever. So that's how I see it.
You're going to be looked at with like no frame of reference as to what you're like when you're not upset. I understand.
I guess you can say that. I'm just saying it's going to make you look bad.
I can't disagree.
And that's your fault. I mean, if you can't control your anger, if you can't control your outburst, then you know what? You can't get mad when someone calls you out on it.
And would you also say it would be fair to assume that not all of his quotes are said in anger? So, for example,
sometimes they're just said in outright stupidity.
Sure, but what I was kind of getting at is I believe that a lot of times he does sort of put on a little bit more as far as being angry and upset because he knows that gets him the reaction. So I think that his
vendetta with Kojima isn't as real as he puts it out. Of course, he maybe has some annoyances with him, and he has some memes like, oh, he credits himself all over the place and stuff like that. How was I supposed to know kind of stuff? But I think that he sort of puts on a little bit because he knows that that's one facet of what still keeps him popular, relevant, however you want to frame it. So would you think it would be fair to say that we can't always just completely discredit something that we assume is said out of anger, because at points he is most likely not specifically in anger, but maybe playing up how he feels and not actually angry and is in full control of what he's saying?
You mean he's exaggerating a bit?
Of course.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, I would agree with that. The easiest thing you can say, though, is that we're all human beings. I think you can tell when someone's being legitimately angry or not. And he might play it up sometimes, but it's easy to tell when he's just spouting hot air. And I think he would just be fine if he admits that every now and then.
Sure.
No, like, the pinnacle of villainy. Just let me interject for just a moment. But I think the pinnacle of Phil pretending to be angry is in his DuckTales playthrough.
I was literally just about to bring that up. Yep.
Epic Rage Within, I believe it was called.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Oh, yeah. No. Yeah. Anyways, go ahead, Sly. Sorry.
When he apologized or whatever for I think on his podcast, he apologized for talking shit about League of Legends players or whatever. And that was the whole thing where he was talking about how he gets hot air. Sometimes he just gets angry and says shit.
Didn't he also say that about Minecraft?
That's fine. Yeah. Yeah. And that's fine. It's just, you know, every now and then you got to come out and admit that. And I think one of his problems is that he's a little bit unwilling to admit, you know, that he's wrong from the outset. So right. That's what his people so mad at him.
Right.
You know,
it almost seems as though him admitting that he was wrong is some sort of sign of weakness, or maybe giving in to the trolls and haters that are formed against him, that kind of thing. I personally feel that his admitting of any sort of wrongdoing, or him admitting that he was wrong, is sort of in his mind giving the haters or detractors a victory.
Oh yeah, he definitely has that defense mechanism.
Sometimes I wonder if he just says those things to like kind of piss people off or whatever, like trying to seek attention that way, but I don't think so. I think he just does it because he, you know, he has an opinion, like everyone else does. Everyone's entitled to their own opinion. So, yeah.
Well, when you're angry, you don't think about, you don't necessarily think about what you're about to say unless you're, like, really self-aware. And that's the whole thing about Phil, is he might come down from his anger later on and go, you know, maybe it was wrong that I said that, or maybe he'll completely forget that he said that. But then when someone calls him out for it, he's a little reluctant to admit he's wrong, because just like you said, that to him, it probably makes him look weak.
Of course. One interesting angle I wanted to look at, we noticed that his popularity is, you know, in a bit of a decline. Do you guys notice at all that when he sort of tries to rally support, that it falls on deaf ears? Does it seem like he has
backfires?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I see what you're going for, and I can't disagree. Whenever he attempts to create a attention-seeking movement in order to basically say, "Hey, look, I'm a new guy, new me, aren't I great?" It doesn't work.
Right.
Like so far the only time he has ever actually changed for the better and actually stuck to it so far is with what we did with the forums, and that's only solely because he needs us.
Right, the stakes were raised in that case.
Well, I'm a little bit louder now because I think the music turned down a little bit, but I wanted to say, do you think he just shits on these other YouTubers maybe to get, like, attention out of them in some way? Because just like how he name-dropped Total Biscuit a multitude of times.
And no. Toby Turner.
I think he shits on YouTubers in general, because much like how he perceives those who dislike him because they can't do what he does for a living, he's a bit envious.
Yeah, I was going to say, I feel like it's either envy or just him being flat out jealous of the people that he talks about, but, you know,
You don't really know. Don't
that was most noticeable in the Tobuscus situation.
Yeah.
I don't think it has anything to do with trying to get attention from those people, though. It's just his yeah. own personal problem.
Well, to make like a 10-minute video saying "fuck you, Toby Turner," yada yada yada, that just doesn't seem very logical to me.
Although on Phil's side of things, I can see one thing that kind of makes Toby a bit of a shitbag. He said he would have a private discussion with Phil, but he never actually messaged back to him. Mm. He said it publicly that he would speak with Phil directly, and he didn't. That's the only kind of, you know, negative connotation I get from Toby Turner, despite his heavy, ham-fisted advertising campaign in every video.
Sure.
Yeah, that kind of turns me off more. But anyways, I digress.
I was going to say, what do you think about the whole him shitting all the YouTubers? He keeps on saying that all YouTubers who does stuff like him are fake, but he says countless times that he doesn't watch anyone's videos. What are your thoughts on that?
Oh, yeah, that definitely contradicts itself. I can't disagree with you there. And yeah. It's more than likely he's getting this information from other people. I mean, it's a pretty common theme that if you're popular on YouTube, you gotta have a gaming channel. Just look at friggin' everybody. Might as well just throw it out there. Friggin' everybody.
Yeah.
The Amazing Atheist has a gaming channel, okay?
Oh, Jesus.
There's a lot of hacks out there in the realm of gameplay videos.
And they only do it because, well, who's the number one subscribed guy on YouTube? There you go.
There you go.
Yep.
And I don't even like that dude.
What's his name again? I can't even remember.
PewDiePie.
Felix Pachacobudia.
Felix, whatever the fuck.
I think his last name is pronounced Kilberg. Because I do remember a Swedish. Because there's a Swedish band that I listen to, and a guy acknowledged his name before. Apparently, because he knows him personally, and he said, and I think that's how he pronounced it. So yeah. Anyway, continue.
Actually, let me go back to PewDiePie real quick. That guy's worth $10 million? What?
Incredible.
Okay. I know. Yeah. Now I'm straight up envious.
Yeah, he makes a lot of money in that from just making silly-ass videos. I have nothing against him, to be honest. I just don't personally like his content.
So. I think the only time I ever bothered to watch his videos as of recent was to see the Silent Hills playable teaser. And that's only because he's, you know, he's the guy for that. That's the guy that you go to. Kind of want to see Phil do it, mainly because he doesn't get scared of that sort of thing, but it'd be nice to see his reaction anyways. By the way, that playable teaser...
Phil got bored. I saw that one. Phil got bored halfway through.
Phil actually made a video like that?
He did playable teaser. He just got bored and lost interest and... He was walking around in circles constantly, oblivious as always.
Oh yeah, that reminds me now. That reminds me now that you brought up PT. How do you feel that he likes to verbally insult or just say very explicit
negative
things, very, very negative things about developers of games, like From Software, Hideo Kojima, you know, all them? What do you think of that?
I actually...
Okay.
Believe it or not, I really, myself and Sly, we have a thing where we just like to basically talk shit about developers and their flaws, but not in the same way that Phil does it. Phil just has one main complaint. Did you guys test your games? He didn't test your games. For me and Sly, it's, here's everything wrong with Kojima. There you go. Here's everything wrong with Troy Baker, and I'm in agreement with Phil. He looks like a hipster. Not gonna lie.
I have a question for the cast of the podcast. Would you say that there are things that people get on Phil about more because he's Phil and it's easier when there are other YouTubers that you could go after for similar things?
Look at iJustine, for instance.
I would say that in general, I think Phil sort of, because of his aggressive stance towards that sort of negativity, that it does sort of spur it on a little more. Again, the whole
You get told you can't do something or that it's undesirable for you to do something. It becomes taboo and then you want to do it more, right? So I think that that's a key component of it. Just in reference to the current climate with gaming, I don't know if it would be the most fruitful for you to go after and attack women in gaming, just because they've sort of flipped this whole Gamergate stuff, and not to get into that, but they've sort of flipped that into not corruption within gaming journalism, but more gamers are attacking women unfairly and that sort of stuff.
Which was already its own agenda and didn't need to be involved in Gamergate.
Exactly. So I just think with the current climate with gaming, I don't know if, at least right now, if we're just talking about why aren't they doing it right now instead of why aren't they doing it in the past, I would say right now it probably just wouldn't be the most fruitful and maybe wouldn't get the most support if you sort of attacked girls in that way, especially female gamers right now. You know, that could change in the future, but I just think right now with that current climate, that's a factor in it.
To me, with the whole situation in what regards to Sly just said, why Phil is such an easy target nowadays? Well, a group of people have slowly started circling around him in the middle of the lunchroom area of the school, and he's sitting in the center of it. He's trying to eat his food, but he's sobbing a bit. Everyone around him is pointing their fingers and laughing at him. But if you think about it, if you're the only person in the auditorium pointing your finger at somebody and laughing, it gets a bit awkward. So you got to have a little bit of buildup. That's well, sort of the same thing with
so
me.
It's,
for that analogy,
so to
though,
boil it down, it's easier to make fun of Phil.
Because everyone else is doing it.
For that analogy, I would say that it is a bit more than that. I don't think it's just a kid sitting there trying to eat a sandwich. I think it's a kid that has been trying to show off and has been bullying other students, now has something against him that people can get at, and he has been taken down a notch. So he was once the bully, the mighty, the you know, the most popular kid in school, if you will, if we're using a school lunchroom as the analogy. He was once one of the most popular kids in school, and now he shit his pants in gym class. And now they all have something to poke at him for, and he's been taken off that pedestal. And now, as he's trying to eat his sandwich, they have found weakness in him. As they poke at him for shitting his pants originally, he's expressed weakness, and maybe he slipped on a banana peel while he tried to run away in anger, and now they can poke at that. And he constantly has different things that people can pick up on, even though they originally were trying to make fun of him for shitting his pants, or in this case, for playing games shittily. They are instead now focusing on his response to that quote-unquote backlash.
But there's people... other people who shit their pants, you know what I'm saying?
Well,
there's other people who are bad at games on YouTube. There's other people that are oblivious in games on YouTube. There's other people who don't put a lot of effort in their videos on YouTube. It's just easier to go after Phil.
Well, I would say that then, just to answer to that, then I would say that this kid is adamant that he did not shit his pants despite everybody saw him.
Okay.
Does that sort of make sense with his, I'm not a bad gamer, I'm not making screw-ups, I'm not a hypocrite, I'm not, that kind of stuff. So it's sort of like, he did shit his pants, everybody saw it, but he is adamantly denying that he did.
Just to add a little bit more to that analogy.
Oh, it's a beautiful analogy.
Let's say while he's trying to eat his sandwich, everyone around him is picking apart everything he's doing wrong and how he should have his shoulders off of the table, how he's slouching, how his pants, you know, they don't match with his shirt, how his sandwich just looks awful.
Pretty much no one lets him go. He never gets any quarter.
Oh, you got a crumb on your face? What the fuck's wrong with you?
But
well, to be fair, it is the internet, and he puts himself out there. So
yes,
any one of us.
The thing I'm saying,
kid who magnifying glass is going to be zoomed in on you very well. It's basically you have the Hubble telescope looking at you when you've had the popularity that Phil had.
What I'm saying is that other people are putting themselves out there. Maybe not completely the same.
We know that other people do the same thing. We're not saying that Phil's the only one that play games bad, or Phil's the only person on YouTube with a bad attitude. We understand that.
He's just the easiest target.
That's what I'm saying. That's my point.
I would say that there are other easy targets. I would say
Justine
would probably be an easy target. Boogie would probably be an easy target, and he has been recently. What's that?
Is he fat?
Because of the character he portrays, because of his...
You missed a joke.
Oh, what's the joke?
You missed that.
What joke?
He's fat. He's...
Oh. Ha, ha.
Sorry. You know, there are other easy targets out there. There's a he might not like for me to say this, but there's a character named Starwind who would be an easy character to pick on. So there are easier targets than Phil, don't get me wrong, but there aren't as many accessible targets as Phil. So again, bringing it back to the lunchroom analogy, this is obviously everybody maybe shit their pants at some point, maybe they didn't do it publicly, but this is a character that has you come over and watch him eat the sandwich. This is a person that actively wants you to eat his sandwich and to compliment him on his etiquette. So the people around him, there's a circle of him that are his friends that are complimenting, oh man, you eat that sandwich really well. You know, when you burped that one time after you ate the sandwich, and that was the bee's knees. That is exactly what I come here for. And they give them their lunch money for it. You then have the group of people that are criticizing him based on him calling attention to himself, based on him turning a racket into getting people's lunch money for watching him eat the sandwich. So I know that we're trying to simplify it as an analogy, but again, it is complex because he is a public figure who is trying to turn this into a business. Well, it is a business. It is his business. So it's not just the same as he's an easy target. He's just an innocent guy there, and we all swarmed onto him. It does have a lot of calling it onto himself.
Don't get me wrong. I'm not calling him innocent. I'm just saying he's easier, but the other thing too is he's not the only one trying to make money off this thing. I think part of it, to be on your side, part of it is his response to people's criticism. If he was a little more easygoing about it, I don't think people would be on him as much, or they wouldn't have been on him as much early in the day or early in the year.
Then again, I mean, he's the type of person that not only makes fun of the way other people eat their sandwiches, but he says that his way of eating the sandwich is superior, and will also go and make fun of the person who made the sandwich, or in this case, made the video games, if it wasn't to his particular liking, even if it was at fault of his own.
I actually wanted to add a little more to this analogy, too. Let's say there are some other kids in school who shat their pants. Basically, what I'm saying is there's... What Sly said, there are other people who do the same thing as Phil and don't get as much shit. Basically, those particular people are so used to it that it just falls on deaf ears, and that's why the attention is never called to it. Phil calls it to so much attention that it just becomes far easier for people to get noticed because of what they're doing.
Yes.
Yeah, it's his reaction. Yeah.
So, of course, to concede to your point, there is, and I don't want to completely dismiss this notion. There is an element of convenience, of course. There is a convenience as to his accessibility, the way that he puts himself out there, the way that he has different mediums for you to be able to communicate with him. So there absolutely is an element of convenience. There also, though, is an element of familiarity. So he's someone that has, basically, he has a deep history. There's a huge backlog on him. He's usually at the center of controversies. So in this analogy, he's shit upon his pants many times.
I got you.
So, obviously, there is definitely an element of convenience to say, yes, he is easy to get to, he's easy to get a reaction from, he's easy to elicit a response from. Your words carry a bit more weight to him when you do direct them at Phil. But I think what we're trying to say from our side, and obviously we don't represent all detractors. I'd like to think that the Sons of Kojima group that you're talking to, obviously we have a lot more members than who's here right now, but I would like to say that we are probably made up of the more influential members. So we've got people like Evil Aging, we've got people like Ren, we've got people like myself and stuff like that, Loophole, people that are notable for having anti-DSP opinions or being critical of him. So obviously I can only speak for a small segment of where we're coming from, and you know, in no way can I completely encapsulate anyone who's ever really had any sort of ill will, because obviously there are people that are completely irrational that go after Phil in a more spiteful and malicious way.
And to be fair to you, there's irrational people from the other side who blindly defend the guy.
Yeah, absolutely. I've had to take care of a few of those. On several occasions, I've actually been called both a fanboy and a hater in the same day.
Right. And again, I think a lot of it has to do with your position. I think that a lot of people from this podcast are going to understand that you aren't in that position in the forum just because, or in any part, actually, the way that you guys have expressed yourself, in any part because you are trying to support Phil or because you are fans of Phil. It's more that you're part of the community. And I think that, honestly, I don't think that a lot of people know that. I know that you possibly have made efforts to say that, but it's possible that there are going to be more people because of this podcast that are going to know about that, both live here and, you know, afterwards when they come back to watch this.
I think I can speak for the majority of the staff, with like one or two exceptions, that all of us pretty much just stick around because we like this community and we don't want to see it fall apart. Although the vanilla forums had a lot more people.
And that actually segues perfectly into a viewer question. And we apologize for not getting into it a little bit sooner. We had some things that we wanted to discuss. So let's get into a stream question real quick, if you guys don't mind.
Go for it.
So we've got one from Hungarian Game Over. And it's, have you guys considered making a forum of your own, not having the King of Hate forums and having that designation of being a Phil supporter, acting on behalf of Phil, but having your own completely separate forums and maybe trying to take the people with you there?
You want to take this one, Slay, or can I?
I don't know. I don't really care, to be honest, so you go ahead.
During our discussion about how we were going to deal with Phil, the thought was brought up, yes, that we could just create another forum and post a link to it in the user-created content, since it would fall under the rules, to be perfectly fair.
Sure.
We can do that. And more than likely, we would have gained some of the people, but we know we wouldn't gain everybody, even though, I'll say it, the majority of the forum doesn't watch Phil's content. We all pretty much jokingly agree about that in some of the threads. Basically, yeah, we all watch Phil's content. Of course we do. You saw that latest video. It was great. But we still intend to. We actually intended to do it should Phil give us the response of, no, I'm not going to change. This is my form. I do what I want. In which case, he would have lost all of us, with the exception of Daniel Swee, who is, by the way, he's new.
Sure.
Here I go using verbal crutches like I'm Adam Sessler.
We all do. I'm guilty of that.
But if Phil does decide to go back on his word, then we are going to more than likely eventually create another forum. That's what Hazer had in mind. He had a few dumb names picked out that I, you know, mocked him for. Like the Free People. What the hell? What the hell's wrong with you guys?
Damn it, Hazer.
First you delete the forums, and then you do this.
Fucking up, man.
You goof. Anyway, but to answer the question entirely, why we are not doing it now is because we are individuals of our word. We had an agreement with Phil. We're not going to turn against that agreement after we got him to agree to it.
Gotcha. So the sentiment before you guys had that agreement was that it would be possible, but now that you guys actually have more of an agreement with him, you guys are going to abide by that.
Until he goes against his word.
Now, something that I noticed that you mentioned was, if you did sort of create this forum and posted the link for it, you would get a number of people, but not everyone would come over. I guess the sort of logical question would be, those people that don't come over, those wouldn't be part of the community that is entrusted to you guys to begin with. So is there something to having that larger, maybe, I guess it might be fair to say unwilling community, but is there something to having a steady influx of Phil-related members fueling this decision, other than the agreement? Let's say the agreement is tossed out the window. That there's an element of presiding over X amount of people, of having a position of power over X amount of people, that factors into your decision. Because again, if it was just that we want to keep this community that we're friends with, we want to take all our friends, those are the people that would come over. But you expressed a little bit of reluctance to that because there would still be people that wouldn't.
It doesn't really have anything to do with us wanting to have more power over a larger number of individuals. For some, it might be that, but for me, it's not. The main reason why I don't like the idea of just a few creating a forum for just a few people is we have Skype for that. We can just create a group and talk there. But if there's
can I interject real quick?
Of course.
I just want to speak solely for myself. I was never involved too much in talking about making a new forum. If Phil was to, you know, basically go against us, I don't know if I would join a new community forum if the moderators decided to make one. I might just move on from the site in general and keep my interactions strictly to Skype unless I saw that the forum had was conducive to discussion that I was interested in.
And why would that be?
I don't know. I feel like if you move everybody from one forum to another, it's going to lose what made the community what it was. So I'm not sure if I would care about it anymore. I would just move on. Okay. If I got to the point where I disagree with Phil, I would just drop from his forum and that's it.
Because that's just the only thing that sort of piques my curiosity in terms of this is, like you said, it loses some of the community, but I would respond that the community is made up of the members. So it seems as though there's some sort of attachment to the infrastructure, to the steady influx of members, to, I don't want to say to the position of power, but just a level of influence, a level of accessibility to new members to make us friends, something like that, other than because it sort of seems like there's a necessity to keep the forums the way they are, even though you aren't specifically fans of Phil anymore, to remain in the Phil forum. So, for example, let's say that I'm not a fan of cars at all, hypothetically, and I go to a car forum and I don't want to talk about cars at all. I want to talk about the news. I want to talk about sports. But people come there and they expect somebody to talk about cars. I guess that's just kind of what I'm getting at is there does seem to be something other than keeping in contact with your friends, because you could do that in other mediums. So there just seems to be something there that's kind of keeping you guys, other than just being able to communicate with the friends that you've made on that forum, because you guys could either take them to another forum or communicate with them through Skype, like you mentioned.
What was the question?
Just maybe to explore a little bit if there's anything other than just keeping in communication with your friends, the community, that keeps you at the forums. Because like I said, there would be other opportunities to speak with this group of friends that you've made at the community on the DSP forums, other than having to necessitate being part of the forum, even though you're not fans of him still.
Oh, that's... The answer for me is simple. The more people there are on a forum, the more chance you'll get to be a bit, the more of a chance you will have to find somebody who may disagree with you or agree with you, and you can still have that discussion. It's always nice to get a new member of the forum who isn't annoying and knows how to read the rules, and basically they just bring up their opinion on something, and you're like, I disagree, and here's why, or I agree, I really like this guy.
Gotcha. So it's basically the influx of new members.
Yeah, and eventually the people who come there because they watch DSP eventually stay because they like the community. That's what we've been told many times.
Gotcha.
And the thing about the community is we're all based off the same thing. is film. So it increases chances that we have a common interest. So there's more stuff to talk about with new people.
As for your analogy about going to a car forum and discussing sports, if that particular forum did have sections for sports or whatever else, like, it'd be kind of weird to go to like a Mazda forum and they had like anime section.
Well, sure. No, of course. But, I guess it's just a little bit more fit to the analogy because it's the King of Hate forums, DSP's forum. Hey, go to my forum so that you can enter into these contests. Go into my forum so you can submit me fan art. Go into my forum so that you can give me feedback on how I can soundproof my room. That kind of stuff. I mean, yeah. The fact that at the end of the day, that forum is created for Phil and by Phil, well, not by Phil, but it's for Phil, and that there just happens to be a community that has grown around it that maybe not is specifically with Phil. You see what I mean?
I understand. And just to throw this out there, probably the least interesting section on the forum is Phil's section. It's actually competing against books, so there you go. My favorite section on the forum, and this is just for me to just bring up randomly without...
Oh, of course. Feel free.
...any question whatsoever, would have to be the general section, mainly because it has my favorite thread, most everyone's favorite thread, and that would be random thoughts.
Ah.
Nobody who comes there to criticize Phil ever visits random thoughts. Phil doesn't visit random thoughts, and that's why it's so much fun to joke about Phil in random thoughts.
Hmm.
That is the most popular thread on the entire forum. It was always that way, too.
I have to admit, I have not checked out Random Thoughts. Maybe I've just outed myself as a diehard critic.
And then,
I just figured it would be more of a fluff topic where people can get their post counts up.
And then someone's going to cry to Phil now and be like, hey, look, they're talking shit about you.
Yeah, see what
thoughts.
You did? Now you're going to have
to, good luck finding it after all those pages. Book club.
Yeah, pretty much.
I ain't afraid of Phil. I don't care.
No, I've seen you go against Phil several times in those private discussions.
Really? So
yeah, it's really great to watch Sly and Phil go at it. Like, yeah, you want to get rid of me? Go for it. I don't care.
So maybe not to get too, maybe not to get too specific. I don't want to make anyone uncomfortable. So there is sort of some pushback behind the scenes that maybe people aren't privy to.
Mm-hmm. Wayne Lord, DX Michael, rest in peace, and Slyspy, they're all very vocally against Phil, whereas I'm just like, do what the fuck you want. I don't care.
My angle is if I agree with him, I publicly agree with him. I'm fair about a lot of stuff. If I disagree with him, I'm gonna publicly disagree with him. And if he doesn't like it, he doesn't like it. I don't have to censor myself to, placate him.
Whereas Wanglord's angle is, I'm going to speak directly for you, Christian, I know you're listening. Wanglord's angle, or Crime Writer's angle, is basically, I don't agree with you, here's every reason why I don't agree with you, and you're stupid. And DX Michael, well, rest in peace.
It's wearing thin, Lemon.
So that DX Michael basically was a fatigue thing. He basically just got a little bit fed up with getting criticized for doing something that he believed in and maybe labeled as an extremist on Phil's side.
No, he was not.
No. Not he at just all. Got tired of moderating. There's no drama behind it. He just got tired of moderating.
Gotcha.
Oh, okay. There might be a slight connotation that he doesn't like the owner of the website, but that isn't going to stop him from visiting it. We have lost in the past one staff member because they just got sick of Phil, and that was Kingslayer. And one day he just creates a thread telling us that he's had enough, he doesn't want to work with Phil any longer, and he left.
Remember Kingslayer. I remember him. Yeah, I've seen something like that, and... I guess he had a good reason to leave. I mean, especially when you're modding forums and stuff. I could see where, the pressure gets to people in that.
The guy was busy, and he just didn't agree with the proprietor, so... I guess it was for the best, in his opinion, to leave. I mean, he hasn't come back yet either. I kind of like, you know, having the guy around.
That's understandable.
So you guys mentioned a little bit earlier extremists on Phil's side. What is your sort of opinion on how that kind of plays out? Do you really see, you know, some recurring themes there with extremists on Phil's side, as in staunch supporters?
I would say it's about the same as his detractors. You got, I mean, you got people unreasonable on both sides.
Yes.
And
if you try to reason with them, they are very firm on where they're at. But depending on the side, quote unquote side, that they're on, they're going to react slightly differently, but it's always pretty much the same, but with different words used. Basically, you don't agree with me, you must be this.
And it only seems to be a lack of individuality in these people. They seem to have some retard hive mind, where they all make the same exact points and think the same exact thoughts.
Well, I'll have you know, I saw a video and allowed it to form my opinions for me.
I've actually seen a tweet that referred to Phil as the hardest working YouTuber.
Don't tell me it was Jamie Scoins.
I'm trying to remember. No, I think it. I, no, you know what? I think it was K Skittles or something like that. K Styles. I remember I retweeted it, and it was I got a good laugh out of it. It was literally some guy that responded.
It's K Styles. It's K Styles. I know Styles? What you're talking about. Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. You mentioned it before, and I know exactly what you're talking about. But go
are you
on.
Familiar with that gentleman?
No, but recently we did get Jamie Scoins on the forum, although he isn't very active. He just enters into contests.
I'm not as familiar with him.
He's the guy that calls everybody a genius.
Ah.
Oh, yeah, he's the one that spams on Scoins, Twitter. He's the one that spams people on Twitter, like, repeatedly.
And stalk celebrities.
Yeah, calling them...
stalk celebrities.
Calling them geniuses.
He's a fucking robot.
Yeah, and he's, racist.
Oh, yeah, I remember.
Well, it's obvious that he's a snatcher.
God damn it, dude. Of course you would make that reference.
How dare you?
Yeah, and he wants to be a woman, too, which is interesting.
Oh, yeah. What the fuck?
Yeah, well, to each their own, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, speaking of the sort of, I guess... extremists on the other side. Is there anyone in particular that you kind of get a laugh from? Is there anyone maybe that you... What's that?
The taco.
The taco. All right. So I think a lot of our viewers are acutely familiar with taco, at least. And we have a suspicion as to who he is. I think a lot of people...
Oh, boy. You mean he posts screenshots from Twitter and YouTube comments? Boy, where have I heard that before?
It seems as though he's, you know, ready to hit that like button on anything that Phil does, even the controversial things. I believe he was the only like on the whole, I think he actually liked the Phil response to the Panda Lee, thread. So he definitely sorts of, you know, because I don't know if you've noticed this, but we've noticed there's been sort of a counter movement in response to the detractors, sort of the DSP World Orders of the world, the others that I, you know, don't want to really give
DSP
attention
world
to.
World Order is taken seriously?
What's that?
DSP World Order is taken
not that they're taking seriously, but just that they exist and they're very active, I guess. They're very...
Yo, Fred.
What's up?
Can I interject?
Of course.
This leads into a question that Carson asked earlier, but he wanted to know, like, what does everyone think of DSP World Order?
Dear God. Sorry.
I don't care. Contrarian horse shit. I don't care.
I forgot
the fact that somebody existed. Comes from just to post this guy's video, and he only has, like, what, 3 subscribers?
You mean the same person who...
Can I sum it up?
Oh, go on, Taurus.
A group of misfits who use misinformation.
Okay,
that's all I can say.
They make a video where it's basically what was it? It's like some
video proving, quote unquote, proving that you guys are making money off of.
Yeah, monetizing videos, and then I post a comment on it. And I know he acknowledged it; otherwise, he wouldn't have made that following video afterwards. I post a thing that Evil AJ posted about how third-party claims still exist, completely nullifying that entire video. And he's like, you know, you're right. You know, it's like, well, you know, I know that because that the proof exists right there. Just it's a third party claim and they still exist. So you're implying that people are making money off that. No, it's not the people that are making money off of it. It's the people that are putting the third party claims on the video itself. So the coding that he's using makes absolutely no sense. And from looking at it in itself, it still makes no sense to me.
AJ, can you imagine if you had the right to make, you know, monetize that this is how you don't play it, those videos in general?
If I did that, I would have felt dirty, honestly.
You'd be dirty with money.
Dude, you could have made like $100 off that shit.
I wouldn't say 100, I'd say more than that.
Yeah,
it's got to be more than that, honestly.
Yeah, okay, my bad. But yeah, you could have made quite a bit off of that, actually.
Would have been rather lucrative, yes.
I have a quick question. Do some of y'all have names or can name drop anybody who you think messes it up for you guys on your camp? Like people who are unreasonable?
Well, I mean, just what comes to mind, I don't want to give them specifically name them specifically, but they released a YouTube video that basically solicited people to use the information they provided with Phil's address and evidences to that actually being his address and to SWAT him.
Yep. Oh, yeah, I remember that. Anyone, the SWAT World Order.
Yeah.
That guy.
And thank you,
Mark. Everyone knows this with this, okay? Anyone who advocates any towards physical violence or, you know, doxing or anything that's just fucking malicious, so we don't support it.
I remember I saw a death threat on Twitter once that some dude was like, oh, I'm rolling into Seattle and don't be surprised if I kill him or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
We don't solicit that shit.
Anyone that actually does any sort of... Anyone that's going to try to manifest something in real life for Phil, even if it's as stupid as giving him a pizza, which is going to inconvenience the pizza place and the driver more than Phil, he's just going to open his door, close it, you know, say I didn't order that. We completely disassociate ourselves with anyone that we haven't really seen anyone in the group doing that. But if they would, we would definitely give them the axe because that completely throws our credibility out the window as a group.
Yes. You know, That harkens me back to the days when KG first did what he did. And because everyone on the forum just globally did not agree with what he did, not a single person, he came onto the forum to defend himself. And then the mods, myself included, the staff basically, were being told that we support him because we didn't ban him. I mean, eventually I banned him for legitimately breaking the rules. And I believe his name, The Taco, comes back to basically reference the lemon. But the fact that people thought that we needed to ban him, even though he hadn't broken any rules, and like I said, the forum is open to everybody so long as you're going to follow the rules, I felt that to be a bit childish, what's the word I'm looking for? They wanted us to take an alignment, basically.
Sure. Oh, of course. Do you think it would be fair to say that both sides consider this gentleman you speak of too
reprehensible? Yeah.
Not just be reprehensible, but that he's basically a joke at this point.
I think some people are on his side. Some people, but they're a minority.
Yeah, recently we have been getting one or two people on the forum who are, I don't know the word to describe them, they might support him, I guess you could say.
Sympathizers?
Yeah, precisely. For instance, an individual on the forum who believes that it would be alright if people paid to break the rules on Phil's stream and just basically greatly inconvenience everybody in the chat, but at least make a buck.
I think I saw that one. So for anyone that isn't aware, okay, so the idea was that people would pay Phil, I think it was through Twitch subscription, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah. they would pay Phil, and then they would be allowed to say whatever they wanted.
Yes. And in return, Phil would make the money that he gets from the subscription, so everybody wins, except for the people who come there to enjoy the chat. But he didn't consider that because he's being a bit too selfish.
Well, it is evilly brilliant, though, wouldn't you say? I mean, if people are going to come to the stream to talk about him anyway, why not get a little bit of money off of it? I mean, obviously, there are other factors at play, of course. Other people, the consideration for other people that are legitimate fans, but that's kind of smart in a way.
Yes, but if... Let me just speak from my perspective. If it were my fan base, it isn't. But if it were, and I had a Twitch fan base, and I had a large detractor group, I would not subject my fan base to having to be in that toxic environment while enjoying my content.
Sure. Oh, of course. I actually saw another idea on Twitter recently, sort of comparing, I believe it was a female streamer, one of those sexually...
Casey Trump?
I think so. Basically, the idea was that Phil can have donations with custom messages that would appear on his stream, not in his chat.
I would hope he doesn't do that.
No, I don't like that idea.
Oh, man. Can you imagine, though? I mean, can you think of how much money that he would rake in by having custom messages?
The fact that...
Could you imagine how much integrity he'd lose if he did that shit?
I mean...
He's already adamantly against donations.
Yeah, it's dumb to have integrity, I know.
Well, I know... No, it's not that it's dumb to have integrity. It's just that I don't believe that he possesses very much at this point, just based on his actions so far. I mean, obviously, yeah, it's good to have integrity, but it seems like he takes stands, for example, like on ALS, where he's citing fake statistics on the amount of money that actually goes to victims. So it doesn't seem as though he has a lot of integrity to begin with, and that his existence at this point is just to make money. You see what I mean?
I would disagree with that. Obviously, I'm not disagreeing that he wants to make money, because that's his job, but he's done things in the past where he knew he was losing money, but he would do it anyway, because he's not just all about the money. He does have a degree of integrity, because I've seen him do playthroughs where he knew he wasn't getting no views on it, but he pushed through it anyway because he liked the game.
Well, I could actually counter that with another recent example that recently he's been doing what I like to coin as view quits, where he has came up with this this basic rule of thumb that if a video does not get 1,000 views on YouTube within the first 24 hours, then he's going to quit that playthrough, regardless as if he's enjoying it or not. So he's done that to Madden. He's done that to what else did he quit?
Transistor.
Yeah,
be watching.
Yeah, so games that he's enjoying now, he does what I like to call view quit, where he will discontinue it because it's not getting enough views, and I think we can understand what views translate into in Phil's world.
I'm not going to say you're wrong because I haven't seen those playthroughs, so I'm going to assume you're correct, but from my perspective, I've seen him do things where he's pressed forward even though he wasn't getting a lot of views or money from it.
Right, and again, this is a recent thing. This is, I believe, within the last 3 months. So I completely understand if you haven't seen it.
Isn't Resident Evil 3 actually not that popular right now?
Yeah, and he finished that. I think Parasite Eve is not that popular either.
Well, he did quit Parasite Eve.
Did he?
Yeah, he said he was not going to play it.
No, I think he was supposed to play it a few days ago, but he canceled the stream for some unknown reason. So I don't know if he's even going to...
I think he just shelved it off, like, for now, but he's going to come back to it.
Yeah, it's probably just on hold right now.
But, yeah, I recall a few days ago, Phil mentioned that he had a tainted Hot Pocket, and he had to cancel his first stream due to that.
Oh, man, I guess, yeah. Can you imagine if he had to formally announce, yeah, I ate a bad Hot Pocket, so everything's off today.
Oh, shit. Fuck no.
And then he went on to say that he ate a Philly cheesesteak Hot Pocket, in which I was like, what the fuck's wrong with you?
Mm. Yeah. Well, any hot pocket in general is not going to be.
Yeah, but at least fantastic. You're going to do eat some pizza or ham and cheese.
All right, there you go. So yeah, I mean that's where we're at now is that Phil has a new phenomenon called the view quit that he has this rule of thumb now, where if a video on YouTube does not reach 1,000 views within 24 hours, he will abandon the playthrough. And like I said, even if he's enjoying it. So for example, he was enjoying Madden, he was enjoying Transistor, he will quit the playthrough full board, full stop, just because.
Would you say that that might be a bit of a rough theory or more of a fact?
I would say that it would be based on evidence that he's specifically saying, I will quit this playthrough if it does not have X amount of views. Yes.
Is it a theory or is it a fact?
It's specifically, I can actually see if I can find
the quote. Well, if he says it, wouldn't that make it a fact?
Yeah, I guess it would actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that happened specifically with Zillia too, I believe.
Right. I mean, that would we didn't just pull these numbers out of anywhere. He specifically said 1,000 views within 24 hours. So.
Oh. Phil himself said this.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, I see.
Yeah, now that I heard that, like, I'm more willing to believe it, actually. If you can pull up the quote and read it to me, that'd be great, though.
Yeah, and also invite our listeners, if you are aware where that quote is, I'll try to find it as well. I believe he said it on Twitch.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm not completely sure. But like I said, I am 100% positive that that was the exact figures that he provided. 1,000 views within 24 hours on YouTube.
For some reason, and it is only what I've come to notice, Phil is a lot more audacious when he speaks via Twitch chat.
Yeah. He seems to open up on his wrestling chats.
Oh yeah.
Yes, Raw Thursdays. Or whenever he does it now. I don't know when he does it, but he'll pretty much address pretty much anything. Not a lot of people around, but he's there. So mostly talk about it.
Yeah.
Is there a reason why he doesn't use the forum chat instead of the Twitch chat? I don't understand that.
He comes into the forum shoutbox once in a blue moon, you could say. Like the day after we did our little mod thing.
Uh-huh.
He was like, "Oh, I'll chat in the chat box. You know, I won't look like I'm completely worried. We're good buddies."
Hmm. Okay.
And after that, I can't recall the last time he did it. Are there any more viewer questions, perhaps?
Let's have a look. Ren, have you checked into the Ask FM?
I am on it right now.
Perfect. Let's have a look here. I wish the chat was completely accessible all the way up, but... Oh, look, we're top of Hitbox. Awesome.
I mean, if they're saying anything negative about me in chat, I can't see it, so have at you.
Sure.
Tell me that my drawing of the lemon looks terrible. I know.
question, do you believe Phil's back-in-the-day stories?
I can't really say, because the last one I heard was a few months ago. I don't really watch 8 Live anymore. Last one I recall is when his friends found porn on his laptop. And that one I was more willing to believe, I suppose.
Of the limited amount of stories I've heard, none of them seem outlandish, so... I guess, I believe it.
I guess the recurring theme that a lot of people pick up on is that all of his stories involve the fact that he's the center of attention, he's the leader of his group, and that all the women in the story want him sexually.
Sounds like the type of stories I'd write in my own fanfic.
So he's usually the hero of his own story, and he's also quite the Casanova. Sort of a Solid Snake kind of character from Metal Gear Solid 1.
Solid Snake is a cool
guy. Solid Snake was very sexual.
Well, I know, but he isn't cool.
Well, okay. You know what? That actually brings me to another question that I had. I just basically remembered from this with the back in the day stories. He had a period after our friend here, Mr. Loophole, called into his show, where directly after in the weeks after that, he was having these extended. I didn't really mean to, but I went over with my stories. The first week, he's like, oh, yeah, I got all caught up in the in the fast food story, and I guess we're just not going to have live callers tonight. And then in the second week thereafter, he did a pre-stream where he said, all right, a lot of people were saying they wanted to call in. I want to specifically make sure that I'm able to do it, but if I don't, we won't have live callers again. But that is my intent, to have live callers. He then, whatever you want to assume, went over again. And then in the chat, he mentioned that a lot of people are saying they don't like the callers. And then he went on his forums and said that he doesn't want to have the people. There's this widespread movement of people that just refuse to listen to the caller segment, and that he would rather not have the caller segment with live callers. Did you guys actually see this movement that he described of people that just hate the live callers and just want them done away with?
To be honest,
I've heard of it a little bit.
In my opinion, and I haven't really seen any of this movement, but in my own honest opinion, the live caller section is probably the worst, in my opinion.
It's just, I have to agree.
A bunch of people who trip over their words and, like myself, but to a greater degree, use verbal crutches. And they usually just ask him questions regarding, hey, you're great. What about this? Hey, what do you think of that? Hey, me and my girlfriend are doing this.
Or they'll say something that he said 15 minutes ago, word for word.
Yes, my God, that is the worst thing. Where they repeat, where they completely regurgitate what he said, and, you know, basically, I agree with this, and then they don't really have a question.
Sure. I mean, I guess we can all see that anytime you do open it up for live callers, that there is the potential to have the mouth breathers that call in and aren't very...
I wouldn't call them mouth breathers, per se. I'd say they're just very shy.
Gotcha. But to frame it as, well, I got prank called 2 weeks ago. The 2 weeks after, I accidentally went over. And now, in week three, I've been listening to this giant movement of people that don't want to have me take live callers anymore. So, for you guys, I'm going to stop taking live callers and thereby eliminate the ability, actual chances of me getting trolled in a way that I can't actually control.
Well, I'm going to say this. I don't know if he's lying or not, whatever, but if the reason why he stopped it is because he's trying to avoid prank calls, he shouldn't. And I'm sorry, I have to trash you for a minute, Loophole. That prank call, I heard it was abysmal. And that, if I had that prank call on me, it wouldn't make me stop taking callers, I'll tell you that much.
Well, the thing is, the joke isn't the joke itself, because it's the same joke that I said already. The point is, he gets mad over it, and he'll defend himself and then try to make himself look better. That's the joke. The joke is not funny. It's been around forever. I've said that since the beginning, that the joke wasn't the joke itself. The joke was that he got so mad over something that is dumb. It just really was.
It's anger through repetition.
So bad prank calls are intentional?
Well, that's the thing. He got mad at a bad prank call. Because he did get very defensive about it. He could just shrug it off and say, wow, that was stupid, or just say something and then go on. But no, and the same day, he talked to the Airy Lord for like 5 minutes. And he only took two callers, and then from that's the thing. I was his last live caller, if that's the case, if he's not doing it again. So I find it questionable if the reason why he stopped doing live calls was all of a sudden people just hated it, because he's dead it for like, what, 20 episodes? And just all of a sudden now he doesn't want to do it anymore? I just find that questionable.
He ruined it for everyone, Loophole.
You know, at least if you were going to make him quit doing prank call, taking calls, the prank call would have been funny.
Well, either way, it got the job done.
Bad job.
I guess.
In my opinion, is Phil no longer taking calls because he had a negative experience with a prank caller? I'm tentative to say maybe. That's maybe with a question mark.
Well, I already said it, but to reiterate, I don't know, so.
Okay, I got a question. It says, would you guys ever consider giving up managing the forum for DSP or moderate and manage other forum for other YouTubers or streamers? Why or why not?
I would give up on Phil when he decides to go against our agreement. I believe I said that one already, but would I be willing to moderate for forums of other people? Sure, I guess, if I have the time and if I'm not doing this moderating job in their position anymore.
That's a weird question to ask. Like, I mean, my decision to go into a forum isn't contingent on if I'm going to moderate it or not. I don't really care.
I mean, if a YouTuber wants to pay me to moderate their forum, I might have to say bye to the King of Hate forum.
Well, Slyspy, didn't you say that if DSP were to, you know, just fuck up or go into a relevancy, would you say that you will stop, moderating for him entirely and just focus on Skype calls?
Well, focus, but, I would drop off the form. I might drop off the form if I don't like the community anymore and I'm not into Phil and whatever. Yeah, but why would I have to think about going to another forum? Like, it doesn't matter to me.
I think they were asking, if you stop moderating for Phil entirely, would you, move on? That's kind of the gist of the question.
Oh, find another position to compensate for our now lacking position as a moderator? No, that would not
happen.
I don't need to compensate. I mean, if it happens, it happens. But I'm not going to actively look for another forum to moderate for.
For me, that would be a no. That would have no connotation or relevance to why I would choose to moderate another forum.
That's understandable.
Since you guys have experience moderating it, you maybe like doing it, so maybe you'd want to do it somewhere else. I don't think they were trying to be rude and say that you guys want to have power or something.
Oh, no.
It's just a weird question to ask.
How is it weird? It's moving
on from DSP to someone else.
I'm sorry, what?
I was just it's asking moving how, on how's
from
it,
Phil
no,
to, like, someone. Are you going to, like, it's saying, are you going to move on from Phil, go to someone else, or go your separate ways? It's something like that.
I don't know.
I'll move on from the forum, but if I go to another forum, it'll have nothing to do with Phil at all. If it happens, it happens. But it's not gonna happen because I left the other forum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or.
Yeah. Now.
And there was another question by Sir Dies a Lot. What is your opinion on the "This Is How You Don't Play" videos?
Evil AJ did them the best, in my opinion. The rest of them, I don't know. They just feel trite and repetitive. It's just, okay, I get the joke. All right, thank you. I mean, I could go back and watch Evil AJ's video. AJ, your video is great, by the way. The Balkan skull theme, that was perfectly placed.
Oh, hey, I have to get off I have to go real quick. I might be back a little later.
All right.
All right.
But, yeah, in my opinion, just the rest of it, just, look at the sheer volume of it. It has become just like Phil's videos, actually. There's just so much quantity, and the quality's lacking nowadays.
I guess... Well, you know, when a new fad happens, there is a mentality to, hop on it. Like, it's something new and fresh in people's minds, and they want to imitate it, you know?
Yeah, but this fad has been going on for a while, wouldn't you agree?
Yeah,
well, I mean, there's so much source big content. Time. I mean, big there's time, there's an abundance of source content, a never-ending stream of inspiration and content for there to be.
It's not even a fad anymore. It's more like a tradition.
Right.
Yo, can I interject real quick?
Sure.
I just want to answer the. I want to answer the last question that was asked before I leave temporarily. The question was, what do I think of "This Is How You Don't Play"? Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
I've seen the first one where Evil AJ, actually I've seen MGS3, MGS2, and I thought they were alright after a while, but I kind of lost interest midway through because, I don't know, 2-hour video, I just lost interest. I agree with Lemon that he does them better than anyone else, though. There's a lot of hacks out there doing the same thing, trying to get...
Wasn't, Yeah, there was also another guy who did This Is How You Don't Play Dark Souls, and in the comment in the info section is basically like up this video so I can get popular.
It's corny. There's too many hacks out there, man.
But there's a big-time YouTuber that actually did one, and he admitted that Phil didn't even finish the fucking playthrough.
But okay, that's it. I'm gonna be gone temporarily, so I'll be back.
Okay.
All right, man. Take care.
All right. Well, I just want to say that there are plenty of people who just rush out them to get pot. Like right now, there's one for Resident Evil 3, and I remember when Resident Evil 2 came out. Yeah, and there was a bunch of Resident Evil 2 ones, and Renegade, who I do think makes good This Is How You Don't Play, and I'm not biased against that. I don't watch all of it because I get disinterested because I can't watch Phil for a lengthened period of time, and I made one. And I enjoyed making it, but I don't know how the quality is. But there are people who make good ones. I think Renegade is probably up there with AJ. He makes good ones. But there are plenty of people. There's like Wily World Order that makes terrible Mega Man This Is How You Don't Plays. But there are some good ones out there.
To add an addendum to what I said, yes, I have seen your This Is How You Don't Play Devil May Cry Renegade. Yeah, that wasn't bad. I don't think it was bad. It just, to me, I didn't have that same feel that I got when I first saw Evil Age's This Is How You Don't Play Metal Gear Solid 2 and 3.
Well, I admit it was my first time doing that, so I kind of got a little better.
Well, you did get the attention of the creator.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Deki Kamiya giving a response was quite the sight to see.
Yep. Indeed. Definitely. But yeah, I mean, I haven't seen any of your more recent work, but... Actually, could someone do me a favor? I'm on a mobile phone right now. Could someone just look up This Is How You Don't Play Bayonetta 2 just to see if it exists?
Probably not.
Let me see. Probably not, but I guess we'll give it a try.
Don't play Bayonetta. No. There's just... Oh, someone made a trailer for it.
That was...
What? Quick.
I know. 1 week ago.
Already, huh?
1 week ago, the trailer for it.
You see what I'm talking about? It isn't even for the sake for the same reason that AJ did his video. And I remember you told me, you said people didn't like the playthrough, but Phil thought people did. And
that's pretty much what happened.
Now people are doing it because the content exists.
Yeah, I can see where you're coming from. That's why there's a lot of poor ones. Like, I remember there was one for Persona 4 Arena. It was terrible. It has a bunch of dislikes. It was just rushed out, kind of.
Make one where it's just basically Phil's video with the laziest form of editing.
Yeah.
That was great.
Oh.
I made one on the Pete on playable teaser just because of how he kept looking at the stream chat and just how it was clear that he was just playing it here's the thing, it was clear he wasn't going anywhere for an hour he wasn't doing anything. He just kept ranting and raving and it was very annoying, and just his views on it and the words he said I felt were very hypocritical and pretty cheap, to be honest. Why I made that one. That's the only one I've made. So,
strikes me doesn't even deserve to be called.
Actually, that reminds me. Speaking of videos that get re-uploaded, did anybody see that video that Hollywood Darkside Phil put up on YouTube? And it was literally fucking Burnout's video of Loophole playing basketball.
Yeah.
No, but he's just as much of an idiot as DSP World Order is.
It's the same guy. I know.
Yeah, he literally just downloaded Burnout's video and put it up on YouTube.
It has his intro and shit. And Burnout said in the comments.
Yeah, right here.
I will say
like a fat piece of shit or something.
I will say that, you know, Loophole, if you work on your footwork, you could have a nice jump shot.
Yeah.
It's all about the feet, man. Let me tell you something. Any sport, boxing, MMA, whatever, dude. Footwork is important.
Unless your job is, like, bowling.
I guess. I mean, I guess they can't run up onto the lane. I don't know. I'm not a big bowler.
Neither am I. Is anybody? Right. No. Yeah, that's just how I feel about the This Is How You Don't Play series as a whole. The whole... It's just a...
Overplayed?
Yeah. It's like a horse that has been beaten so severely that a house is now built upon it because they didn't even realize it was a horse. They just thought it was dirt.
Yeah. And a lot of times they just add filler to it, too. They don't add anything worth the value or something that you said that was very, derogatory or just really mean-spirited or bad, which I thought AJ pointed out in his video very well. A lot of times just, oh, he died, and that's it.
By the way, how do you make a This Is How You Don't Play Dark Souls when it's the person's first time?
Sorry about that. I just came back. What's going on?
One of us died.
Slyspy went for a bit.
Yes. Anyways, I believe Mike's like the This Is How You Don't Play series. This question has been beaten into the ground. Do we have any others?
Yeah.
I've actually made one not too long ago.
Awesome.
Does anyone here have questions? Just like any random ones?
Oh, well, the Lemon, I have a question for you. It's from Wanglord, actually.
Oh, really?
Yes. He says, great. What do you guys think of the forums? A lot of you swung back when shit went down, and it seems a decent number of you have stuck around.
What does he mean by when shit went down? Like, what Phil did?
I'm guessing so. He didn't really go into specifics about it.
Well, he swung back, too. He's still with us. So I guess he could answer his own question in that regard, but I suppose why I stuck around? Community. I like it. I couldn't resist the chance to grab Phil by the balls and tell him what to do. That was great, too. That was a joke. Let's see. What else? Why else? I don't know. I guess it's for me, it's just tradition now. Next time I get on a computer, I just look at the forums, see how things are going, read every thread, make sure nobody's being a dick. But it's more or less a science that I can easily dispose of, because if Phil wants to go against me, he's making quite the enemy. Especially considering I better not go into that. But I know Russ, the owner of the Facebook page for Phil, could easily turn that page into something that Phil does not want it to be. And I don't know, if Phil were to spite me, I might attempt to spite him.
An eye for an eye, I see.
I don't know, I guess I am somewhat petty.
So, maybe I'm speaking out of turn, but it seems as though the alliance, maybe to romanticize it a bit, the alliance that you have with Phil is a bit tenuous.
Yeah, there's a bit of conflict in it. Not, not now. At least not right now.
Sure.
There might be in the future. I wouldn't put it past us. Us as in, the staff and Phil as a whole. We do clash quite often. Yeah, I suppose that wouldn't be an unfair judgment to make.
Okay. Because I just think it would be beneficial for the listeners to get the full sort of... Not full story, but just, the full grasp of... you guys aren't just sheep of his. You guys aren't just, carrying out his will and foot soldiers in his army. You guys have your own wills, have your own viewpoints,
At
times especially clash with them.
Especially since Phil doesn't even get to choose the moderators. If he wanted to pick someone to be a moderator, we would all screen him and give, screen them, gender ambiguous. We would screen them in the same way we always did. We always... There have been many occasions where names were brought up and a lot of us said no. The people who have been around and in a moderating position or admin position since before I was put into the moderating position I am in are only there because Phil, I guess, is somewhat responsible, but luckily those were the good choices. People like Ranculus and Naughty Nightwear and Vegeta. Those are bad choices, Phil, because all of those people came back to bite you.
Naughty Nightware created a DSP cult leader. Ranculus is responsible for getting Phil kicked off of Blip. Vegeta created, well, I guess this to a minor extent, Vegeta created a basically a hate-based Ventrilo group that I used to go into on occasion just to see what they're talking about.
So you can say that they did it out of spite?
Not exactly. They didn't. Phil didn't do anything to spite them. They did these things before, well, with the exception of Ranculus, they did these things before Phil did anything by stripping them of their power.
Would you say that Phil is unnecessarily harsh or especially demanding on his volunteers? I've seen different people come from being a moderator on his chat or a moderator on his forums and then go and say things like, well, he would be completely, he would not be understanding if I had something personal I had to do. He demanded that I would be on his Twitch stream. I was unfairly criticized. He told me that I was doing nothing when I was actually there. Things like that. Do you see any sort of...
Yes.
And then maybe that would be the source of the tension that actually comes up.
Yes and no. Yes to your first question, no to the second. That doesn't have any connotation to the tension.
Well, not specifically with you guys, but like I said, you just kind of mentioned a few people that went on to do things against Phil, and I was just maybe trying to get at maybe they sign up to be a volunteer of his, he puts unfair expectations, or he's overly hard on them, and then they start to say, to hell with this guy, I'm going to do my own thing.
In our experience as staff members, we haven't... I'm sorry, I wasn't speaking close to the microphone. In our experience as staff members, we haven't exactly experienced Phil saying that we have to do things. He's been unreasonable, that's for sure. He's in the past said that we aren't doing, enough. And on those occasions, we basically took screenshots of everything we did, and he didn't respond because he knew he'd been beat. And... That topic has only ever come up twice. Once on the vanilla forums, and that's when we used the screenshots. And a second time, in which case the same thing happened, but we didn't use screenshots. We described to him why he's asking too much. He's asking us to step out of our bounds. We aren't there to have power over people. We're there to make the community better. We're there to make the community more friendly. We're there to make sure everyone's enjoying themselves without having to deal with assholes. We are not the power. We are the people. We're the janitors. That's the best way I can describe it. We are the janitors.
Ah.
And everyone else is the guest inside of the janitorium who's being treated like every other individual human being deserves to be treated. And we're janitors with the ability to basically say, hey, you're not allowed in this building because you're doing this. But we don't do that to everybody. We only do it to people who literally know that they're breaking the rules.
Gotcha.
Sorry
to cut you off. Go ahead. No problem.
That second thread, by the way, that was put in the staff discussion on the newer forums where Phil basically told us that he wants us to get rid of negativity instead of, by using aforementioned shadow rules, basically you're not allowed to be mean. Or not mean, but you're not allowed to say things that people don't like you to say when they don't even break the rules, is what Phil wanted for a short period of time, and we told him why that's a bad idea. Didn't get a response there. And that brings me to this. The moderator revolt. We put it out publicly. Phil was upset that it was put out publicly. And we respectfully declined to have the discussion privately because we knew from experience that we would not get a reply after that. And that's why it was put out publicly.
Gotcha. And I think a lot of people on both sides respected that decision because it forced accountability from him. It did not let him completely dictate the narrative, what he's going to tell people, what was the result of it. It would have been inefficient for you guys to have to post screenshots, something like that. So I personally, and I think a lot of other people respected that decision to have it public because it was something of interest, not just for you guys, but being a sign of solidarity, not just for you guys, but also for fans to really understand what was going on there.
And that's the way we kind of wanted it, but that's not the main reason why we did it. Like I said, we only did it because we wanted to elicit a response from Phil, and we wanted it soon. That's why it was over with so quickly, because Phil had to respond.
Gotcha. And
people like to say that we came crawling back to Phil. No, he came crawling back to us. If you read the post, you would see that. And the very next time he decides to shit on our front lawn, he's going to lose us.
Of course.
Didn't one of the people in here say that? Didn't one of the people in this podcast say that we came crawling back to him? Loophole.
What? Oh, on Twitter? I didn't know the whole story, and yeah, I was ignorant if that was the case.
Yeah, it was just an opinion. You don't know the full story.
Yeah, I really didn't. All I got was shit I knew on Twitter, so I was not aware of anything. Yeah, I might have been on the forums, but if I did, I was not aware of the full story.
Bro, just being honest here, and you gotta, to be fair, you gotta hold yourselves accountable as much as you hold anybody else accountable. So, not to call you out.
That's what we're doing. That's
what we're doing. But not to just call you out, but I had to be honest there.
Oh, I said it. But I'm just explaining why I said it.
And it's fine.
I didn't know what the point was, or like you guys were, you guys had a commitment to fill or whatever to moderate his thing, or that I didn't know how it worked, to be honest. I never really went to the forums that much.
And that's perfectly fine. Knowledge comes to you in waves. Some people absorb it sooner, some people get it from others, and that's perfectly fine, like I said.
Yeah, consider that a lesson learned, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Sly, really if you want to call it that.
Sly, you're so mean.
Bro, I'm being honest, dog.
I get you, dog. Don't worry, I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah, you're my... I'm not sure how the audience would feel about me resorting to my normal jokes, so I won't.
Oh, feel free.
Oh, all right.
Well, there's a question on the SFM, so... You want me to answer that or go with the joke first?
No, I was just gonna say straight up nigga.
Oh.
Oh.
Well, like I said, we'll edit that out for you. No worries.
Oh, you ain't got it.
No, it's not live or anything, so no worries there. Nobody heard that.
Not
edgy.
At all.
Edgy.
I'm straight up edgy. I'm Sunset Overdrive over here.
Whoa.
Oh God.
Anyways, you can go with the question. Sly's black. It's okay. I have an
Why
excuse.
Are white people only edgy on the internet?
Because
well,
I'm
the safe. Question is. The question is, do guests think that DSP talking to the SOK and addressing his flaws and his haters will be a good thing for his appearance online and how he's perceived?
I think the entirety of that question is based on how Phil does it in general. If Phil's going to speak with them and be apprehensive about speaking with them and just acts like he doesn't want to be there the whole time, it will only discredit his personality further.
Sure.
The other thing, too, is even if it goes really well and, you know, a lot of people are turned, there's always going to be some people who are just unreasonable and will find a way to be against them anyway.
Sure. I mean, I think it would do more good than harm. I know that Phil has expressed, I think when the debate stuff happened and stuff like that, he actually expressed wanting the ability to speak to people in an organized way that was in some way neutral or whatever else like that. I know that I believe it was Lemon that was agreeing to moderate the actual debate between Che, who's here, and Phil if they did agree to the term. If Phil did agree to the terms, obviously Che is the one that offered the debate in the first place. But I know that Phil has expressed a desire to actually want to speak with, maybe not us specifically, but people that have, any sort of, criticism for him in that way, especially organized criticism. And, I think that, you know, at the end of the day, if he does decide to come on the show or speak to us in some other form, maybe if we have some of his moderators there with him or something like that, any configuration of it, that it would be positive because we would be able to express ourselves in a way that isn't 140 characters on Twitter, that isn't just limited to text in a forum post. where we can express where we're coming from. Maybe he can express where he's coming from. And then at the end of the day, we can both have a better understanding of each other. I agree that that probably won't be the end all be all and end all of his negativity. But I think at the end of the day, it would do some benefit more than if he just never did have that sort of conversation with us or whatever other representatives. I just say us because I feel that we would be fairly organized and civil in the way that we would, you know, talk to him if that ever came to be.
You saying in general?
I think too. I think too for this to work, it would have to be on even ground. Like I think it shouldn't happen on this podcast, and it shouldn't happen on his podcast. It should be on even ground where nobody's too comfortable. You know,
Omar's podcast.
Perfect. Yeah, well. Hey, that's what I was saying. I even offered that one of you guys can moderate and that you could say that to being even because you're modding his forums. It's like I'm not trying to get anyone that, you know, in the group here are affiliated with me to mod the debate. It could be any one of you guys. I'm perfectly fine with that. As long as it's fair, I don't really care.
I have experience in moderating discussions, yes. But like I said, I would only do it if it fell under my timeline.
That's fine.
I personally don't have interest in moderating that debate, but I don't have anything against it.
No, that's fine. I appreciate the support.
So I guess we'll try to look for some more viewer questions for the two of you. Are there any other questions, curiosities that you had for us that you wanted to get out while you're here, while we have you?
I got a question.
What do you think of us as guests so far?
Okay. I think that you guys have represented yourselves well. I appreciate, you know, the conversation that we've had so far. Obviously, I admit that I've been speaking most for the group since I've had a lot of time to prepare for this. I've prepared questions and that kind of stuff. So obviously, this discussion was more me and you guys talking, but you know, with everybody else too. But in general, I think that you guys represented yourselves well. I think that you guys expressed some key points that would be good for people to know going forward. So, for example, that you guys are there and you guys are committed to the community instead of being committed to assisting Phil in his business. I think that you guys kind of represented yourselves as being independently minded from Phil and not just completely agreeing with everything that he says. And so far, I honestly think this has been a great episode. A lot of people in the chat have expressed that it's been a great episode. And, you know, like I said, I appreciate you guys taking the time to come on and talk to us.
But how many people have called me an egotistical shithead yet?
Just me, but I muted myself. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, like, along with Joelbit and Timbo from 2 weeks ago, it's been a nice conversation, and while, what should I say here?
We're
not trying to get anyone to switch sides. That's not what the point was. The point was we would get out our ideas and talk about it, rather than trying to force someone to think one way or another way, and that's why I think that doing this has been a really positive experience on both sides. And while we might not agree, of course, I think it's nice to hear other people's opinions.
Right. And sort of to throw the question back on you guys, obviously, I know that you guys, took it upon yourselves to, obviously, I've seen Lemon, you agreed to be part of the show after seeing,
you know,
the Timbo broadcast, and I know Slyspy had a few questions that he wanted me to clear up before he came on, so that sort of signaled he had just a little bit of hesitation. Being guests on and getting to actually talk to us and see how we actually communicate our opinions and stuff like that, what do you guys think about, you know, being on our show?
Let me go first in this regard. Sly, do you know the only reason we're here is because I decided to talk to Fred Fox while I was drunk?
Oh, you were drunk, okay.
Oh, I was like, yep, I volunteer straight up. But yeah, so far it's actually not been too bad. I mean, like, personal experience with what's going on with me right now, I'm not feeling too great. Like, I'm feeling queasy, I haven't eaten today, but this whole discussion has been nice. I like it. It's not exactly the worst discussion I've had. I blame that to Omar. He's a terrible host.
So far, yeah, I'd give this discussion a 4 out of 5, X Play style.
Now he's reviewing our podcast. Look what you Excellent. Made him do.
Well, I think you should work on the delivery. I think it should be, I give it a 4 out of 5.
Straight up, Adam. No, actually, if I want to be more like Adam, so sorry. I give.
God fucking Adam Sessler, like, that guy is a shill. I don't care. That guy, I don't call people shills. That guy is a shill. Fucking, well, I give Titanfall a 5 out of 5. I mean, seriously, like, he did this shit back in G4 and he didn't even in GameSpot. That was like a long time ago, man.
Oh, and it looks like a user in the stream chat actually called it out. Lance K, Fred seduced you. That is correct. I did seduce the lemon while he was drunk. That was sort of my thing. I knew that he was intoxicated and I figured now would be the time.
Fred, we all know you're secretly a succubus. Come on now.
Well.
We all know this.
I will not confirm nor deny that allegation.
You're clearly Morgan Ainslin, okay? That's what you're saying.
To be honest, I probably would be drunk right now on this podcast, making an ass out of myself if it weren't for the last time I got drunk being hit by a car. And I was like, yeah, maybe I should stop drinking.
Oh. I guess that car tried to turn lemons into lemonade.
someone said sour. Oh my God. Someone just said sour sex.
Throwing out the window.
That guy was drunk too, by the way. We were both drunk. He hit
me. So it kind of cancels itself out.
Yeah, perfectly. He comes out of the car, right? He's like, oh, dude, are you okay? I was like, no, I'm not okay. You hit me with your car. And he's like, well, I gotta go. I was like, you fucking prick. And I was too drunk to stop.
Oh, wow. Look, there's a lot of love for me in the chat. I want to thank all you guys for the kind words. That's very nice. I appreciate that. I try my best. You know, this is a group thing. So I try to, you know, share my skills with the group. I'm a bit of a politicker, if you will. A politician, I guess. But not in a corrupt way.
Politicizing.
Fred is our god.
Yeah, taking all the credit here.
Hey, I'm just reflecting what the chat's saying.
Sure, keep stroking that fucking
base spread.
No, so far, all of the hosts have been great, with the exception of AJ.
Fucking AJ.
Oh shit! Shots being fired.
Fucking whore. Goddamn.
You know, the only reason why AJ isn't so great is because I had to point out to him how to do vamp on the hardest difficulty.
Ooh.
And I remember that shit. Dude, I thought that, man, I can't believe that shit fucking worked, dude. That is ridiculous.
It's a lovely little strategy, though.
Good old unbelievable vamp
games.
Fred can save WWE. Well, look, I don't have any sort of attachments towards them. I watched like 10 years ago, and now we're watching again. I, you know, if I was to become part of the writing staff, maybe. Yeah, maybe I could save them. Maybe we'll bring back the Attitude Era. But, yeah, I can't. There's nothing I can do about that one. That's,
if I were a writer for WWE, I would just write a character so facetious, so transparent, that he is obviously Chris Benoit. That everyone would just love it.
The Disabler.
That's right.
Why don't you make his gimmick is that he kills his family?
Coming straight out of parts unknown, killed his family.
I think the stock would drop through the freaking floor if that happened. There's no way. They would not. I mean, obviously, being a public company, they're responsible to their shareholders.
I feel insulted, mostly because Chris Benoit is Canadian as well.
And he didn't even eat Canadian bacon before he died, too. What's up with that?
God damn, man. That could have given him some freaking manpower, too.
Oh, shit.
Fucking Canadians. Hey, is it Canadian bacon or ham?
It's regular bacon. Just
maybe,
bacon. Yeah.
Maybe you ate one of those McMooglers.
Oh, God.
I said to a Canadian once, that's Canadian bacon. He's like, no, it's ham. Fuck that shit. Fucking
is
bullshit.
Is Canadian bacon just like plastic or rubber?
Ham. What'd you get, McDonald's? Yeah.
it's just rubber.
Yeah.
It's raw.
And also, Moogle likes putting ketchup on grilled cheese sandwiches, which is fucking gross. But, what? You know, like, Canadians do that shit.
What's wrong with that?
It's gross, dude.
How is it gross? Know, like,
I don't get people who put ketchup on eggs.
Fuck ketchup.
I think that comes from Japan, right?
Ketchup is only good on, like, hamburgers and stuff.
Ketchup? I use ketchup on, like, meatloaf, and that's it. I don't put ketchup on my fries.
Hey, you guys should have no right to judge anybody who puts ketchup on anything. Come on now.
Loophole's a motherfucker here who said ketchup is candy, so...
That's right. Fucking loophole. Oh, I don't want to be known as the basketball kid anymore. I want to be known as the stupid guy that thinks everything with sugar plus other ingredients is candy.
Isn't ketchup,
It's a condiment. It's a sauce.
I know.
He thinks sugar. That it's candy. It's
straight up sugar, though.
It's not straight up sugar.
Hey, Lemon knows what I'm talking about. Not saying it is actually candy.
Okay, well, a donut is straight up sugar. That doesn't make it candy.
Let me tell you people something. Lemon's taste buds are dull, so he's not a good person to go to find out if something tastes good.
Yeah, he's right there. I've actually lost.
He's just got a sour tongue. I mean,
I've actually lost about 80% of my ability to taste. It's gonna be 100% rather soon, but
so no points in your direction, Mr. Sugar. Sugar, ketchup.
Hey, I read the ingredients, okay? I think I'm one of the few Americans who do.
I don't know about few. There's a lot of people who get hysterical about high fructose corn syrup.
I'm going straight up vegetarian.
Oh, shit. You know, actually, you know
what? You gonna eat sandwiches from Subway?
Oh, go fuck yourself.
You know, it's funny. There's actually really good vegetarian meals out there. If you look in, like, a craft cookbook, they have some really fucking good meals in there.
You know, I learned something rather shocking about veganism, and well, not about veganism, just an item that is meant, it's completely vegan, basically. And you might not believe me when I tell you, it's Oreos. Oreos is vegan-friendly.
Interesting.
Good for them.
But they support gay pride, so go fuck them.
Yeah, you can be like that guy from Scott Pilgrim and get some vegan powers.
I don't like gay people, and I don't like people who aren't white, damn it.
we have a question for AJ. Does you're AJ 95%. Put mustard on his meatloaf?
Oh, dude.
No, dude, fuck mustard. I don't fuck with that shit.
Mustard on meatloaf's actually not that bad.
That even like sound mustard. Nasty.
I know a guy who puts ketchup on his
dude,
tacos.
Fuck mustard.
I know someone who cooks mac and cheese with mustard in it.
Oh, God.
Dude.
Oh, God.
What? That's actually good. It actually is good.
Yeah,
you wouldn't think it's good, but it's good.
It is really good.
What about ketchup and mac and cheese?
Nope.
It's not.
Nah.
How about cheese and mac and cheese? How about that?
How about real cheese and mac and cheese?
That's overkill.
I could tell.
Ricotta cheese and macaroni cheese, right?
No,
right, Moogle?
No, shut up, Fred. Shut up. I don't want to hear it.
Come on.
I don't want to fucking hear it.
Come on.
I don't want to hear it. Fuck ricotta cheese.
Well, while we're on this little funny topic, I got something funny and something that doesn't deserve to be taken seriously at all.
Oh, good, for once.
Yeah, here's something that doesn't deserve to be taken seriously at all, and it's a pretty funny joke. His name is Event Status.
Oh, yeah.
Bot shired.
Oh, my God.
I got some straight up evidence that DSP is a pedophile. I saw a comment on a YouTube video.
Ooh.
Oh, that's going to stand up in court. Good for you. High five.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, when I saw that, that
was pretty stupid.
Yeah, when I saw that, I said he did get some good evidence, but the whole pedophile thing, not a whole lot.
So, let's,
the thing that surprises is how many people championed this dude. Like he was really right about everything he was saying. What his inconclusive evidence.
You know what I love about the comment section of that video is people who called him out on being incorrect and for having insufficient evidence. He basically just trolled them. Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that. Like, his comments were like, you know, I'm just going to say Phil is a pedophile just because.
Because it helps my cause, damn it.
Yeah.
And what's his cause to challenge him to Street Fighter? Wow.
You're loser really going gets out off on limb there, bro.
Oh, yeah, that was
Let's be honest. Once he made that challenge, DSP was never going to accept it.
Well, yeah, if he lost, he has to delete his YouTuber account or something ridiculous.
Yeah, it's like,
you have to destroy your livelihood if you lose
against me, but if I lose, I just stop talking about you. Yeah, that's fair.
I mean, what else DSP has? Get a real job? He can't do that.
I don't know.
Yeah, his life on YouTube depends on him.
Right.
Yeah. That's why everything's hit or miss with him nowadays. Yeah.
Remember that little parody thread I created during April Fool's Day, Sly, about Phil actually being a frying pan?
I don't remember that.
Yeah, I made a little thread in Phil's section basically saying, accusing him of being a frying
pan. I made a lot of parody threads back in the day.
Parody threads are so fun to make, especially when you're making fun of such, to be honest, something that's being taken too seriously. Right now, there was a thread on the forum about somebody complaining that Phil is stirring his sauce too often. Okay? That exists. Make of that what you know.
I actually thought of something. I thought about this for like a long time. Do you think Phil is kind of ripping off ABGN?
He said that he was inspired by him, I recall.
Because I kind of thought that because he does blame the games and the developers on saying the only thing difference between ABGN, he only does it with game companies who actually make bad games. DSP does it with almost every game he plays.
The funny thing is that LGN actually made good games when the Super Nintendo came around. You'd be surprised.
Made a good game.
Yeah, they made a few good games.
They made a few good games.
Name one game.
Fucking Maximum Carnage.
Maximum Carnage.
Exactly, one game.
The first Spider-Man game that came out on the Super Nintendo. That game was awesome.
Yeah, that game was good.
I'm trying to think. What else?
Spider-Man 2 is also fun, but they didn't make it.
No. It was another game. I don't think it was a Spider-Man game, though. I can't fucking remember. Yeah, you have to give me a bit.
So, while we're wrapping up there, I just want to give the 10-minute warning. So, what we're going to do, we had a lot of questions on our Ask FM that weren't specifically related to our guests. So, it would be your guys' call if you guys want to say your goodbyes now, or if you guys want to stick around to the end while we field some questions that have probably little to nothing to do with you guys.
I'll stick around while you guys pad your ego.
Awesome. Fantastic. Well, it would be our fans padding our ego.
Right.
So, Mr. Rick, to make fun of your fans, please let him rip.
All right. Someone asked, "Do you have any other guests planned for next week?"
Oh, what? Because
we are currently looking into having Jack Jr. Yeah. I've been in talks with having Jack Jr. I'm also in some talks with some other guests. Won't reveal it now, just in case something falls through. I don't want them to get any kind of flack as if they flaked on us. So just know that I am in talks with some pretty high-profile guys in the gaming community. And as always, we're after the Holy Grail. We're looking to have the Iron Sheik on. So, that's as far as I'm going. Anybody else have any kind of guests that they have that they've been talking to lately?
Larry Bundy Jr. is definitely a
I was actually on the list.
Yeah,
I was actually tweeting at him not too long ago. He says he was just overcoming a flu, but he did say he wanted to be on the podcast.
Wait, what?
Yep.
Is that the guy who's famous for commenting, but he doesn't make any content?
He makes
content a lot.
He said to me when he gets over his flu, he said he would actually come on the podcast.
Larry Bundy Jr.?
Yeah, he said that.
Wow, okay.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I was tweeting at him. Let me find the tweet, actually.
News to me.
We believe you, man.
So,
oh, you know what? I see it right now.
I just see his comments everywhere.
What else you got for us, Ren?
Someone asked, what's the possibility of Aerie Lord being a guest?
That'd be up to him. Yeah, if he wants to get on, I don't see any problem with having him on. Obviously, it'd be a group decision if we want to have him on or not, but personally speaking, I don't see any reason why not.
I believe my co-host, Omar, once spoke about wanting to be on the show as well.
I'm not sure who that is.
Right in the Blood Edge.
Who is Omar?
He's the guy with the anime avatar that spoke in your thread.
AKA Right in the Blood Edge.
Oh, okay. Yeah, actually, I spoke to him. He said that he can only do Friday, Saturday, or Sunday, I believe. So we have done podcasts on Saturday, but not SOKcast. So we might have to do a pre-taped and then just air it on the podcast as is.
Okay. Someone asked, what kind of lube does Fred fuck you for his asshole? What the fuck?
What? Okay.
Yeah, that's one that Renegade just made up.
He uses ketchup and mustard.
I use oxygen.
That's an anonymous question.
He uses orange marmalade.
Vegemite.
At least I don't use lemon marmalade.
Oh, fuck you. Well, not literally.
Someone asked, can we discuss whether or not DSP contract with Machinima will change for 2015?
I have a feeling it will.
I have a feeling it will. I think that I heard something about the impact of content ID matches affecting ad revenue and stuff like that. So possibly. My belief, a little bit unrelated, but my belief with Pandalee's Machinima contract, I don't believe they've actually had to cut her a check ever at all because of her views. So they probably forgot that she's still part of Machinima. So I don't think hers will be in jeopardy. I don't think they even know that she's part of their team.
Hell, I didn't even know she was part of Machinima. All
right, I'm going to segue into some gaming questions. Someone asked, does anyone on the stream now has any guilty pleasure games that they're playing at the moment?
Oh my dear God, every time I get asked this question, it always flies back to me playing Time and Eternity.
I'm surprised not Dota, but you know.
Dota's not a bad game, though. That's the thing. Fucking Time and Eternity is a terrible fucking game.
God damn.
Terrible guilty pleasure games. Mine would be Hitman Absolution for speedruns.
Really? Okay, that's interesting. Huh. Mine is Magus on the PS3, and nobody's ever heard of it, but it's awesome. It's fucking terrible, but it's awesome.
Terrible games.
Terrible.
Terrible.
At least you should, I can see it as terrible, unless, Kanan is dead, man.
Yeah, oh, God, no, that's just flat out bad.
Yeah.
For me, it'd probably be Marvel Nemesis for the PS2. Good old fashioned fighting game, even though not a lot of people like that. It's like it for just for certain reasons.
Someone said if it all crashes, burns, and completely quits YouTube and Twitch, what will happen to the SOK?
We've branched off into other stuff. We just basically became friends around initially not liking Phil and having criticism about him. So we would still remain a group of friends, except for Loophole. We would not associate with him anymore.
This included.
Fuck Loophole.
Probably the same thing would happen to the forums, to be honest.
Yeah.
What else you got, Ren?
Let's see. I'm looking
through. How many more you got?
Just about a couple more. Someone asked another one about some Mighty Number 9 shit. I was like, what's your opinion on Concept opening a new crowdfunding operation for a DLC for Mighty Number 9? Do you think they should have waited for the game to be released? Greetings, RC. I don't know who RC is specifically, but whatever.
Royal Crown Cola.
That's right.
Or remote control. How about, I can put it this way. I think that just in general that them crowdfunding content is great because they're not accountable to a developer or a publisher. And therefore they have a lot more creative license when it comes to the finished product. So anything that has to do with the crowdfunding or basically motivating other people to see it as a lucrative business or something that they can actually do as an alternative to going with the publisher, I completely support. So,
yeah, I can attest to something like that. The next question is, does it cut you deep that some people in the gaming community who will think Phil is a general gamer and will represent the gaming community with his content?
People think that?
I believe so, yeah.
Well, tell them to stop it.
Well, that's just sort of their question, but
that's a good response.
I mean, there's plenty of people who misrepresent the community other than DSP, and they do it on such a grand scale that it's pretty unbelievable.
People like especially the people, Raw Instinct.
Yeah, especially people who just clearly they don't give a shit about their fans and they do it just for a paycheck. I think when it comes to that disjoint of a gaming community in terms of a fan base, then yeah, there's a lot of people who can represent the community quite easily.
Smosh Games, I Just Eat
and
Games.
And there's people who don't care about games in general. And yeah, they're using the opinions of people who don't care about games in general to get an opinion of a sample size.
Yeah, I Just Eat is a big one for me because she was a fucking blogger and shit before she even got into games. So
have you seen her play Portal 2?
Oh god!
Oh, I saw god. That shit.
Yeah, there's actually a video.
One of you guys.
There's a video called 12-year-old versus I Just Eat or something.
He doesn't play video games.
You guys should do a This Is How You Don't Play on that. To be honest,
I think someone did something like that. Just wasn't called that.
I think. Yeah, I think.
Yeah,
I just
told you.
Yeah.
What else you got, Ren?
Let me see. Someone asked, do you think Panda Lee is cheating on DSP with Vash?
Not yet.
Oh, God.
That guy showed up in the comment section once on the forum. I think I banned him because, obviously.
With who?
Or Vash, really?
You banned him, why? Because it was an imposter?
No, because he was trolling.
Oh. I mean, I just think it's weird that they moved to the West Coast and all of a sudden Panda Lee starts talking to a guy with an established YouTube and Twitch presence and starts, for all intents and purposes, flirting with them. I mean, it just seems like a concerted effort between the two to get him to do play to do co-op with them, just being honest. She's not just talking to some random dude. She's talking to a dude with a YouTube and Twitch presence that has the potential to do playthroughs with Phil in co-op while he does want a co-op partner. So that's just my take on this whole Panda Vash thing.
Despite the whole Panda Lee thing, I think Phil would, he would benefit from Lord Vash being a co-op partner. I'm not so sure how Lord Vash would feel about it. You might see some dislikes on his videos if Phil's in them. Just throwing that out there.
I know, but I think they're looking at it more the DSP, the benefit of DSP. Phil and Panda Lee, I think, are looking at it in terms of getting a replacement for John Rambo.
Seen Phil as someone who was interested in playing with, actively interested in looking for other people to play with.
He did. He was actually going to do a playthrough with the guy that you said I sound like, but that fell through.
And SSOHP.
Wasn't that... But he didn't initiate that, did he?
Yes, he did.
That was the other guy.
No, he did.
No, he did. Same thing with Sheamus or SSO.
Yeah, he was also asking Sheamus. And yes. supposedly he also asked Larry Bundy Jr.
Oh, yeah. Larry talked about that.
Damn, Slyspy.
That's how he found out that Larry didn't like him.
Okay.
Best Slyspy.
Slyspy.
Say what?
Okay, I got you.
Damn, Slyspy, get owned, man.
Okay.
You got owned.
Make you feel better,
buddy. What's that?
Okay. I got two more questions and a
joke.
Disclaimer.
I mean, you've been throwing them a lot out, so
we just always have to. Yeah, you've been having a little bit of jokes. I figured I'd give you one to close with, you know?
I feel you.
Yeah. But I got two more questions and a disclaimer. Like, guys, if your questions does not get answered, they're going to be saved for next week. So I'm just letting you guys know that. There's a question for Loophole and there's a question for Fred. The one is, why is Loophole so fucking bad at basketball in full detail? Even Woody Harrelson can out-dunk him and white men can't jump.
Oh, man.
Well, complete silence, everybody. Let's get this one.
No. Okay, well, first off, let's get the reference to a shitty movie out of the way. White Man Can't Jump. That was fake. And second of all, sucking at basketball, that was a video taken by my friend in January. And he posted it in Vine, like, a couple months after because he saw it. And I just want to say that. It was a three-pointer, and I got rim, and so I can't be the worst. Because there's Pruane 2 forever, and he's out there.
But you did, actually, the first bounce that you made of the basketball went straight into your groin.
Okay, I was trying to go through my legs, and I was trying to do some spiffy shit, and I can't do that because I'm white.
Dude, I loved for fucking Loophole and Pruane 2 forever to like have a 1v1 basketball match.
Ooh, okay. Or a fight, because you know Pruane could fight too.
You know, watching them fight would be like two paraplegic kids slapping each other.
Alright, Renegade, let's close out the show. You said you got one last question for us.
Alright, for you, Fred.
Oh!
Someone asked...
saved the last for most important, of course.
Well, they said, does Fred Fox speak in public often or something? He seems very confident and clear when he speaks. Surprisingly, I'm not annoyed listening to him like most people online.
Wow. Well, I wrote that myself, of course. Well, I am a political science major. I have a bachelor's degree in political science. I'm pursuing a master's degree in political science at the University of Illinois. So I have spoke publicly a lot. That's a big part of it. And I feel like obviously my first attempts to do any kind of broadcasting was literally a couple weeks ago. I went onto a stream with a friend of ours to do a Let's Endure. I wasn't as confident then, but I've been doing, I think I've done about 10 podcasts since. Me and Che do the Shootcast, doing the SOK cast, and I've taken it a bit seriously. I've got a new mic now, so I appreciate that very much. I still don't think that I'm that great. With everything I do, I'm my toughest critic, so hearing something like that, I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, Fred, you joined me on my birthday stream as well, and you were pretty vocal as well, so. Uh-oh.
And then he died.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Rest in peace, Fred.
Oh, no, I didn't die. I was just I was letting you shower me with compliments. Sorry. I didn't want to cut you off while we were talking how awesome I am. Why would I do that?
I was like, why did the call go quiet all of a sudden? Oh, well, anyway, yeah.
All right, and that's all we have for questions. If I missed anything, we will be answering it next week.
Renegade, I got a quick question for you.
Oh, God.
What?
He's going to challenge you to a game of basketball.
Yeah.
He's going to lose? Yeah.
Okay. Now, I got a legit question for you, dude. Why do you play games on easy mode and then talk about how great you are?
Well, I play Evil Within on Akimu on YouTube.
Yeah, who'd you share play with?
I share play with your bitch ass, and you fucking kill me all the time because you're a horrible partner.
Yeah, okay. That's just because you suck, dude. That has nothing to do with skill.
That's just,
At least fucking Renegade ain't a irrational shopper that can't wait a week for a sale.
Oh,
I paid an extra 50
bones for that X-Bone.
Hey, that was in August, and still...
You could cancel pre-orders, my friend.
Xbox.
I think it was shipping already by the time the deals were announced.
I think you and Ren should settle this on a little 1v1 on Twitch, huh?
1v1 on... You know what? Well, he is getting smashed, so we'll see.
You're getting NBA 2K15, right?
Yes, NBA.
You can play that.
And you get destroyed.
So we went about 10 minutes over, just because we wanted to take those questions. We don't want to ignore those questions. We just had two guests that we had a nice long conversation with. I feel like it was very productive. I feel like both sides expressed themselves very well. And I think that everyone listening got a better idea of maybe where we were coming from, where they are coming from, and what their intentions and motivations are to do what they do. So I want to thank everybody for tuning in. Of course, again, we really appreciate having you, Lemon, and having you, Slyspy, agree to give us your time to come on and talk to us. And
I would just like to say, yes, we do apologize for running 10 minutes over, so we won't be having any live callers. Sorry, guys.
God damn it.
Wow.
Thread killed.
Way to go, man.
Now I heard people don't even like live callers, so it's all good.
Yeah. Sorry, guys. We won't have live callers this week or the next week. People have voted, you know, that the live callers are pointless. Yeah, sorry.
And because of the antics tonight, we're not going to have any more live guests either. We're going to run over on that. So
yeah, we're just going to talk about back of our days.
So anyways, this girl really wanted my cack. She raped me in the back of the room when we were
working.
Wow. I was tossing the salads, and she just completely raped me back there.
Okay, I've heard enough.
Hey, man, rape joke.
Okay. She told me to go die.
You told me to go die. Make sure you guys subscribe. I really need your subscriptions. $5 a month, custom emotes. And if you guys don't spread the word, what the fuck?
I'm going to block you.
Anyways, yeah, I'd like to thank everyone for being able to come on here. It was nice to speak to you again.
Of course.
And, I had fun here. It was a decent time.
Excellent.
There was no alcohol, but, you know.
Myself, I came in not knowing what to expect, because I meant to check out one of your podcasts to see what it was like, but I didn't really get the time.
Yeah, they're bad, so... No, I'm just kidding. All
right. I'll take your word for it. But, it wasn't a bad experience, I guess. It was all right.
Super. So, I guess we'll just close the show with the normal Moogle. Go ahead and head through us. We'll do our plugs, and you can see where to find us, and we'll get the hell out of here.
I guess we'll go ahead and start off with Che.
Che, that's your cue.
You're on.
Hey, you already know all about me, so just thanks for the support. We love you guys, and I don't know, hit me up on Twitter or something.
Where can they find you on Twitter, Che?
You can find me at RetrospectivePC.
Woo!
Woohoo!
How about you, Torres?
You can follow me on YouTube, The Superior Artist 10,000, for animations or This How You Don't Plays.
What about you, Evil AJ?
Just find me on Twitter, all that gay shit. All
right. Okay, then. What about you, Loophole?
Loophole 572 everywhere, and that's it. There's no fucking special
thing. Especially on the basketball field.
What about
you? That's
all right.
They call me Hoophole on the basketball field.
Good name.
What about you?
Oh yeah, wait.
573 pointer.
What were you gonna say, Taurus?
I say heads up. I've got another drawing planned.
Oh my dear God. To an
old movie. No.
Oh no.
And it's. And this one is for your famous boy Loophole.
That's going to be the superior drawing.
Oh, all right. Anyway, what about you, Mr. President?
Ren Operative on Twitter, Renegade Operative on YouTube.
All right. What about you, dude, man? I know you came in here late, but you can plug your shit.
Goodness. I don't feel like plugging.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, I just want to let you guys know, you guys can hear the sexy voice of Dude Demand right there. We're going to try to have a segment where Dude Demand and Satsuki actually speak to each other.
Satsuki World Order.
We're going to have them speak to each other, and we're going to have that as a segment on the podcast. I feel like their voice is going very much unnoticed, and we really want to get their voice out in the world.
And we're going to have some pornography.
And then we'll have the live duet of them singing Never Gonna Give You Up by Rick Astley.
God damn right.
No.
Oh my God. Gonna have like 70s jazz music or something.
70s porn music. Man, come on.
Or something like that.
Anyway, I guess Lemon, where can we find you?
My channel on YouTube is Ray William Johnson. I'd really appreciate it if you subscribe.
And in the produce section of your local grocery store.
Wait, can I be honest? Is he still relevant?
No.
Nah. Ray William Johnson.
No, he's not. What about you, Slyspy?
I have no plugs, just one closing statement. Hideo Kojima is an overrated hack. Stop supporting him.
Ooh.
Oh, you shit.
I agree.
All right. AJ, right in your feels,
oh,
dude.
Oh, man.
All right, Fred. What about you?
We are not. Well, first of all, just a disclaimer. We are not responsible for that outburst. And any ensuing shitstorm that is about to happen towards these two gentlemen, we would appreciate if it does not reflect upon us. The statements of our guests do not reflect that of the Sons of Kojima podcast or Sons of Kojima Incorporated.
I'm thirsty. Fill me with your glass of your tea.
You can drink some lemonade. So what we're going to do, for me, you can find me on Twitter at T-I-H-Y-D-P, acronym for This Is How You Don't Play. You can also find me on YouTube, Fred Fox. The proper URL would be It's Fred Fox. And yeah, that's usually it. If I'm not Fred Fox, I'm It's Fred Fox, because usually my name is taken, and I'm not too happy about that.
All right. Well, I haven't plugged my stuff yet, but if you guys want to go ahead and find me on YouTube and on Twitter, you can... Oh, shit. Hold on. Something's wrong here. You can find me at Brandon Lost World without the O in world, and you can find me at Movie Master 102 on YouTube. And that's pretty much it. So... Yeah, I'd like to thank all the wonderful guests we have here and all the wonderful hosts we have in this podcast. Hope you guys enjoyed this episode of the SOK Cast, and we'll see you next week.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye.